Blog Talk Radio.
2017. Big Truth. The Big Talk for You. What up? Shout out Albo King. Big Boo. Me. Shout out everybody. Check it. Hey, yo, the Big Talk for you so you can absorb. Information free of charge so you can afford. Get popping. Live off the greatest doctrine. Sip the juice, know the ledge like the great Rakim. On a mission, not a small time thing. Defense, biblical, offense, got the haters watching. Hands and skill, footwork is ill. Get in the den, see if you can stand for real. If you rep Kim and Cool, yo, I rep Israel. If you Torah based only or new as well, welcome to listen. Style always fair decision. Two sides come together to compare what's written. Seeking the facts, seeking the max, teaching the acts, leaking the tracks. Call while you eating your snacks. Music in my bones, DNA, C, double E, and K. Little something for the showtime, it's a play. One love.
Listening to the Big Talk Feed Radio.
Hey guys, this is G-Man from Preaching to the Choir Ministries. I got to make this quick. Yo, I'm offering General Tazariot, General Johanna, Pastor Doel, and Donald Ringo $100 per hour to come on my YouTube channel to debate me. I particularly want the ISUPK on them, particularly General Johanna or Tazariot, and I will gladly give Sal the money up front for those boys to come on my YouTube channel to prove to me whether or not Jesus actually died for the nation of Israel, or did Jesus die for the sins of the whole world, and that would include the so-called white man, and I would love to have that discussion between those two. Also, when you guys aren't listening to Debate Talk for You, I know you guys get a lot of great material here. Check out the G Podcast on the same channel. Type in G-Man, and you'll see the G Podcast every Monday at 7:30 Eastern Standard Time, every Monday. 7:30 Eastern Standard Time, where you see Christians and the Black Hebrew Israelites going back and forth. You'll see Vocab Malone, myself, you'll see Faithful, and a plethora of other people. And guys, I know you listen to Debate Talk for You. Get back to your debate, and peace. God bless.
Hi, this is Tyrone Thompson, host of the Blog Talk Radio broadcast, Talk Real Solutions. Please tune in and listen to all of our shows 7 nights a week at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. At Talk Real Solutions, we cover a variety of topics to ensure we speak about what may be needed in our community at any time. Talk Real Solutions is the hottest blog talk radio show going on right now. You can listen to our broadcast at www.blogtalkradio.com/talkrealsolutions or visit our website at www.talkrealsolutions.com. Also, like our Facebook page at www.facebook.com/talkrealsolutions. You can call in at any time during the show and add to the conversation and offer your solutions at 1-858-357-8453. That's 1-858-357-8453. Because at Talk Real Solutions, we want to make sure you have a chance to talk real solutions.
You don't want to miss checking out the most controversial video of the year. Everybody's talking about it. A video produced by Absolute Bible Truth teacher, Brother Josh. The video is entitled, Is There a Secret Gay Agenda Amongst the Comedic Conscious Groups? Once again, it's one of the most talked about videos right now, and you want to make sure you go check it out. So go to the website, www.absolutebibletruth.com/store. And once you get it, it's an automatic download. You'd have to wait for it to be sent to you in the mail. It's an automatic download. So once again, go check out the video, get it fast, and get it now.
Shalom, Israel. This is Brother Robert, a.k.a. Pastor Nobody, from the Fountain of Israel Bible Studies class. You can find us on thefountainofisrael.com or use the search box on YouTube and type in Fountain of Israel. You can also email us at foibiblestudies@inbox.com. Again, that is foibiblestudies@inbox.com. We believe the whole Bible is the truth and relevant to our lives today. Join us weekly as we feed the flock with the uncut word of God. Matthew 4:4 says, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God." So until next time, this is Pastor Nobody. Search the scriptures and prove all things. Shalom, Israel.
Blessed be our Father God and His Son, Jesus Christ. This is your beloved Brother LeVar, cult teacher at Absolute Bible Truth Ministries, and I'm taking this tremendous opportunity that Brother Sal has given me to invite you guys out there listening to the Absolute Bible Truth broadcast on Blog Talk Radio. If you are out there and you have been searching for biblical truth, or you want answers to your questions, you can catch us every Saturday, the weekly Sabbath day our Father has given us. We begin our teaching in between 4 and 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Call in by dialing 319-527-6197. Again, call in by dialing 319-527-6197. Our lead teacher, Brother Josh, serves us up a meal, and I promise you, if you have a hunger for understanding the Word, you will get full. Also, like our Facebook page, which is the title of our ministry, Absolute Bible Truth, all one word. In addition to that, check out our website, absolutebibletruth.com, for other study material and online classes. Absolute Bible Truth is a congregation who focuses on the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth concerning the Word of God, while leaving out all personal opinion, speculation, and belief. Thank you.
What it do, people? It's your boy B. Lit Dive, and I'm chilling over here with my man, Sal Showtime, man. And I'm just here to let y'all know that there's only one place that you need to go to hear the word from the word, man. And that's at Debate Talk For You, man. I'm going to slow it down, man, because a lot of people slow. I speak fast because I'm from New York, but, you know, I'm going to slow it down, man. That's Debate Talk For You. Hosted by my man Sit Al Showtime. You dig? Keep it tuned, man. You already know what it is.
Peace and shalom. This is Emuna Yisrael from the Sunshine State, and I am tuned into Debate Talk For You, the place where you can get intellectual exchange with no profanity. I love it. One.
Study to show thyself approved. You're now listening to the Baby Talk Be Radio.
This is Ronald Francois representing from Atlanta, Georgia. And when I'm not busy in the studio, I'm checking out Debate Talk For You Radio. Keep up the great work, Sal Showtime.
What's going on, family? How you guys doing? Welcome to another show. You're now listening to Season 7 of Debate Talk For You Radio. Of course, I'm your host, Sal Showtime, and this is the hot seat segment of Debate Talk For You Radio, where we invite special guests to come on the platform for you to listen to the audience to finally ask your questions and your comments by dialing that number, 319-527-6239. You know, a lot of people that we invite on the show, you see them in lectures, you see them on YouTube, and you never really get a chance to ask your questions. Well, today is your time to finally get your questions answered. All you got to do is dial that number. Again, it's 319-527-6239. For those that are new, you can call in via phone, call in via Skype. And when you call in, you got to press number 1. will add one to the conversation. We're going to have the Soldiers of God here tonight, right here on Debate Talk Radio. There's a lot of members of the Soldiers of God. And so some of them have pressed number one, some of them haven't. So for those that's on the phone lines, if you didn't press number one and you're part of the team, Soldiers of God, please do me a favor, press number one, and that'll let me know that you're on a switchboard and we can bring you all in. I see a few of the members already standing by. We're going to definitely introduce them to the world out there. You have a lot of listeners via phone and via Skype. Again, if you have a question or a comment, people, y'all can press number one as well. If you know you're going to have a question or a comment, you can press number one and we'll add you in the conversation. Again, it's going to be a 60-minute segment or more, depending on, you know, if you want to extend the time. But we're going to require 60 minutes for the audience out there to finally get your questions answered. You can send me an email also at debatetalkfeed@gmail.com. That's debatetalk, the number four, and the letter U at gmail.com. Well, let's start off by introducing the team one by one. My first guest, you know him as G-Man. He's been on the show actually a couple seasons before. You can check out his YouTube channel by typing in the search box G-Man. He is here live, one of the members of the Soldiers of God. This is the G-Man. Welcome to the show.
Hey, I'm happy to be here today, and I'm hoping I can answer some questions today. I'm hoping that somebody will get something from this, and I'm hoping somebody from the One West camps, particularly IUIC, will actually have the courage to call in today and ask us a couple of questions. You know, we don't bite. We're nice people, you know, and I would love for them to call in and ask a question today.
Hell yeah, we appreciate you, man. Do me a favor, mute your phone. I'm here mute your phone. Yeah, there we go. Matter of fact, I'm gonna have, you know, being that we have so many people on the team, like the Wu-Tang Clan out, everybody's gonna have to definitely mute their phones, you know, as we go along. But let's go to the next member of the Soldiers of God. Let me see on the switchboard. We have my brother Marcus. Welcome to the show.
Hey, how y'all doing? Can you hear me?
Yeah, you loud and clear, man. What's going on with you, brother?
Nothing much, man. You know, the same old thing, man. Reading the scriptures, studying it, you know, praying. That's it, y'all. God bless everybody out there listening.
Yeah, like I said, mute your mics as we go along and introduce the Soldiers of God, all the members of the Soldiers of God. Once again, if you're out there, there's a lot of people on the switchboard. So if I missed anybody on the switchboard, just press number one and we'll bring you in. Let's go to the next member of the Soldiers of God. This is the First Lady of the SOG right here. This is Sister Sherry. Welcome to the show.
Hey, Brother Sal. This is your girl, Sister Cherry Love. How you doing? SOG all day.
All right. What's happening with you? How you doing?
I'm good. I'm glad to be here, glad to talk to the people, and ready to answer some questions.
All right. So do me a favor to mute your phone. And let's go to the next person. Let's go to my brother. He's been debating inside the Lion's Den. You know, he's doing his own thing as well on YouTube. Check out the channel on YouTube, So Real. This is So Real. Welcome to the show.
Hey, what's going on, everybody? It's good to be here. How y'all doing?
All right, we're doing pretty good, man. What's the latest, man? What's happening?
Oh, man. Well, you know, I don't know if I said it before, but I definitely went broke last week because you know, I took my girlfriend out for her birthday all day, went to Cheesecake Factory and P.F. Chang's for some, you know, a little marriage counseling here and there. And, you know, just we really had a really, really good day. So I had to, you know, I had to one-up her because, you know, the week before, she took me to Comic-Con. So because it was, you know, our birthday is on the 11th and the 15th. So, you know, that's pretty much what's been going on. Other than that, been really doing a lot of studying into the Old Testament a lot. And, I just hope that the IUIC actually call in with actual doctrinal questions and not cheat the crowd into just other irrelevant stuff. You know, but hey, if they don't call in, I won't be surprised because, you know, I know they have a business to run and, you know, I could definitely understand that. So other than that, I'm looking forward to really just talking to, you know, the audience and just being open and real and just whatever questions that they have, I'm really going to try to just answer them to the best of my ability and hopefully we could just slowly take our time and just walk through some stuff together. And other than that, that's it. You know, Christ bless everybody.
All right. Once again, that's So Real right here on the Big Talk Radio, Soldiers of God. Next member of Soldiers of God we have is my brother right here, my brother Vekul. Welcome to the show. What's going on, man?
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you now. How you doing?
Mm-hmm. All right. Doing great. Great. Ready to answer some questions and hear some comments and stuff like that. So it's good to hear everybody.
Hey, what's going on with the cartoon, brother? What's happening?
It's in process. Just taking a little while. Got a little one on the way. So that's kind of taking up some time, too. So, but
Congratulations on that. Congratulations on that. No doubt. That's what's
Thanks.
Up. Newborn. Yeah, man. We appreciate you, man. All right, so those are the only members that pressed number one so far. I'm going to be looking for some more members, of course. You know, like I said, if you're a part of the team, press one. You know, we're going to go, you know, start the show off, though, in a few minutes. But once again, people, if you have any questions or comments, this is your time to, you know, dial that number as well and press the number. Of course, I'm going to throw a few questions out there to start it off at the beginning. But again, it's going to be a 60-minute segment or more. Like I said, I have the timer ready. And actually, this is a historical show right here. This is the most members we ever had on Hot Seat right here on the Big Talk Radio. So we definitely appreciate the Soldiers of God coming on in attendance. So let's go. Matter of fact, let's start it off. And let me start this clock. And let me ask the first question. All right, let me start off with Soul Real. Soul Real, get it?
Yeah, I'm here.
All right, so just to start it off, the first question. Let people know what the Soldiers of God stand for and what the Soldiers of God is all about.
You know, to sum it up, you know, what the Soldiers of God really stand for are, you know, we're really just, you know, a lot of passionate Christians that each have our own background story as to why we really do put up such a front, you know, and a real balance against the Hebrew Israelite doctrines. We each have our own background story as to why we are in this work. You know, and not only that, but, you know, what we really stand for is the real Christians that really do have a robust theology and answer and life that we live. And a lot of things that we bring forth are once again, just nothing new. It's very old stuff. We stand against the modern accusations that, you know, that Christianity is just, you know, some whitewashed religion, a white man's religion. It's business run and all these kinds of things. We really try to put, you know, a balance against that, you know, and to show, you know, the faith and practice of what Christians have always believed versus, you know, these kind of very new kind of accusations and things. And to really, you know, really just kind of end a lot of the myths, you know, about the quote unquote pork chop preacher and all these other things that, you know, a lot of Israelites will say. Now, I do know that, you know, a good bit of my friends are Israelites, and they often always tell us that we are not to put Israelites in all of the same camp. They believe in a whole, you know, different range of things. You know, they believe in the same things just in different ways. Kind of sounds like Protestants, you know? So that's why I often say that when it comes to these kind of accusations, well, you have these in your church. Well, what about your camps? You know, so the real issue is sin. You know, and so, yeah, we're really here to really end a lot of those myths that, you know, cause people to leave Christianity and leave the church. And also to just kind of just once again, put at the forefront again of what Christians have always believed and what they've just how they've always just lived their lives in practice, you know, and that's what we're really here to do.
All right. By the way, we have Vocab Malone in the building. Vocab, say hello to the people.
Hey, what's going on? Glad to be on.
All right, man. My brother Vocab, what's happening, man? What's been going on with you?
Just doing a lot of Little League baseball games. I got three boys, and they're all in three different levels of Little League, so I'm at that field pretty much every day. Not literally, but almost.
I get that workout on. It's all good. That's cool. That's yep. cool. All right, so we're going to pass the question around. Like I said, it's a lot of members of the team. And, you know, you can just unmute yourself for those who want to answer on the team. I guess Vocab Malone, I got you on the line right now. Let the world know what Soldiers of God stand for, in your opinion.
Yeah, SOG is a collective of different brothers and sisters who love Jesus Christ, are his disciples, don't claim to be perfect or know it all, but realize that the gospel is the only message for a lost and dying world. And so we want to propagate the gospel first and foremost. But we come from all different types of backgrounds, from all different parts of the country, and there's even different denominations represented within the crew. That's true. And we have a common goal, though, nonetheless, which is the propagation of the gospel, and sometimes that includes the defense of the gospel. And so there's a specified mission within SOG, which is to be able to defend the gospel against things that would diminish its power when you change the message. And that's a big concern we have with some of the things that we discuss and talk about, is that the power of the gospel and the true saving nature of it gets diminished when things get added on top of it. And so we want to do our best to defend the full, robust gospel that is proclaimed in the scriptures.
All right, let's go to G-Man. G-Man, what does the Soldiers of God stand for to you?
I won't be long. First of all, I hope you guys can hear me. SOG stands for earnestly contending for the faith, as it says in Jude. We have a lot of people in the Hebrew Israelite camps that say a lot of things about Christians that are not true, like we're cowards, we don't understand the scriptures, you know, our churches are producing girly men. A lot of them call us false teachers. A lot of them call us pagans, and none of those things are true. And just like the other guy said, you know, we're here to preach a living Christ to a dying world, and we want people to know the truth about Christ, and we want people to know the truth about Christianity and what we are versus what the Hebrew Israelites are saying we are. We're none of the things that they're talking about. As Vocab said, we're not perfect. We're a group of Christians that care about the faith, and we're going to do everything we can to defend this faith at all costs. We understand the dangers. We understand the risk we're putting ourselves at. But at the end of the day, this is all about Jesus Christ and not about us.
I believe we have LaRon Campbell, a.k.a. G-Consciousness, in the building. Say hello to the masses, G-Con.
What's going on? Peace, SOG in the building. Peace to the SOG affiliates. Peace to the family out there. What's going on, South Showtime? How y'all doing tonight, man?
We doing good. We doing good. We all here. We go. Glad you joined us. And once again, we have some people out here. Like I said, some people calling in. I have a lot of people on the phone lines. But again, you got to press number one, people. Got to press number one if you want to add your, you know, some of your questions in this conversation. Of course, I'm going to start it off with a few questions out there. But again, we're waiting for more people to call in. I'm trying to get all the members to finally be a part of the panel. I think that's it. But we're going to keep on searching. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to the first lady of SOG. Sherry, how you doing?
I'm doing just fine. Doing just fine, Sal.
All right, here's the question. You know, being that you're the first lady of, you know, the SOG, let the people know what is your role, and also let them know, you know, how does it feel, you know, to be a part of such a huge team. Right.
Oh my goodness. I am overwhelmed by these brothers. These men are true men of God. Outstanding, excellent, wonderful, caring, bold warriors. The list can go on about these brothers. Each and every one of them holds such a special quality within themselves, within the body of Christ, and definitely within my heart. I am so privileged to work with them, to, I mean, just to, you know, just to be a part of the, a group with them. Words just can't, I don't have the words to really give you. My role in the SOG, and a lot of women who have seen on the outskirts of what SOG is, they're very surprised that strong men like this, like them, allow a woman to take part, because, you know, a lot of women are, you know, have been kept out, especially dealing with the biblical word. They are my family. I have my own family, but they are a whole nother family, almost a higher family within God. So, I, like I said, I'm so privileged to work with them and to call these men my brothers. My role in SOG is I'm the counselor, the nurturer. I deal with various issues with regarding women, even men whose spouses have been indoctrinated by the One Westerns. Everybody's familiar with them and know what they do, and it's horrible. They're a complete heresy. They are the modern-day Sadducees and Pharisees, and I have no problem speaking out against them. I have no problem getting in their face. I have no problem telling them what the Word of God says. And I know I get hit with, well, a woman is not subjected to teach. Well, you know, if you felt that way, well, you know what? You shouldn't address me. You walked away from that scripture already. So once you do that, and I'm letting the men in the audience know, once you do that, and if you feel that way, you walked away from that scripture, so don't even come with that. But other than that, these brothers have definitely have taught me. These brothers have definitely nurtured me back. So not only am I giving to them, but they're giving back to me. And I'm blessed. I am truly, truly blessed to be not only a woman of God, but to be a woman in SOG. SOG is soldiers to God. We are warriors of God, and we don't play no games. So, yes, I'm standing by strong, strong men of God, and I'm so, so proud of that. I hope that answers your question.
All right, family, once again, it's the Hot Seat segment right here on Debate Talk for You, where you, the listening audience, can ask, audience can ask your questions live. Dial that number, 319-527-6239. You can dial in via phone, dial in via Skype. Like I said, I'm just going to ask a few questions before we get to the audience. You know, but in the meanwhile, you can press number one and stand by. I'm going to get to y'all. Let me go to my brother Marcus. Brother Marcus, man, what's going on? What's happening? Can you hear me, brother
Hey,
Marcus?
Hey, how's it going? Yeah, I'm here. My bad.
Okay.
I actually had it.
Yeah, that's cool. I mean, you know, we all know your story. From some of us that saw the interview that went down on you know, on YouTube, you were a former member of the IUIC. Is that correct?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
All right, man. Since you've been, you know, in a debate platform as far as you know, going against some of the Hebrew Israelites, things of that nature, let us know some of the responses, or have you received any backlash since you've been, you know, in the trenches, you know, going against some of the Black Hebrew Israelites?
I mean, I've gotten positive feedback, negative feedback. You know, it just depends on what exactly we're speaking of. On some of the debates that I've done, let's see, I've done one on you know, is Jesus in the Old Testament? You know, we debated some Israelites with that. Then we also did some debates concerning the law. You know, do believers have to keep, how do we keep new covenant? Also, do we have to keep the Sabbath day and the dietary laws? I've heard positive feedback, you know, from brothers and sisters, and also I've heard some negative feedback, you know, from those who say things, you know, to me, I think it's more extreme. You know, they take things far to the left. Like, for instance, you know, obviously, you know, from the debates, I pointed, you know, the point, my position is that we are not under the Old Covenant law. And therefore, there are things that we no longer are required to do as a believer today. And because, you know, I hold that position, many, many Israelites, they get it twisted as if, you know, I'm saying, you know, that being a Christian means you can be lawless. You know, you basically can do anything. You know, you can kill, you can commit adultery, you can steal. None of those things have ever been stated by a Christian. And you know, to me, I just feel like it's like a big straw man thing every single time. And so that's basically, you know, like what I've gathered, you know, from, you know, the time that I've been doing the debates, and also, you know, just from me being a part of the movement itself, it's been a major straw man against Christians when, you know, concerning those things, concerning the matters of the law and stuff like that. So hopefully that answers your question.
All right, let's go to my brother, Vekul. Vekul, can you hear me?
Yep, I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I got you loud and clear. My next question, and again, we're just going to wait for some more people to call in, press number one, and then we're going to, you know, go to the audience. But let's just get straight to the nitty-gritty as far as, you know, some of the debates. I'm pretty sure you listen to some of the team members, some of their debates on Debate Talk for you. You see some of the things going on YouTube. Let the people know, like, what are you, or what not you particularly, but what is the team want to address when it comes to the Black Hebrew Israelites? What do you guys want to expose that?
Well, from my observation and my personal goals as well, I think we all want to get people away from this idea that because because it seems to me that with the majority of these Hebrew Israelite groups, the majority, their foundation of everything that they believe seems to be based on the skin color, the physical identity of Jesus Christ and the people of Israel. And then from everything else stems from there. And you're ridiculed or you're considered a heretic if you disagree with any of their doctrines that are not validated by Scripture. I guess from my position, I'm just kind of thankful to be a part of this group because we got guys like G Consciousness, Marcus, who are former members of this movement, and we got Sister Cherry, you know, who's female, speaking boldly in defense of the faith. We got Vocab, who obviously is, you know, not Black, but he's very knowledgeable in this field. And then you got the rest of us, G-Man, Surreal, and and everyone else, and myself, we're trying to encourage other Black people who might be confronted by these groups, and they're pressured to believing in these doctrines that are being purported by these radical Hebrew Israelite groups, and letting them know that you don't have to be ashamed to disagree with them or just deny many of the core doctrines that they have that are contrary to Scripture. All you need is Christ. That's all you need. And Christ never showed any type of discrimination with different racial groups or anything of the sort. So we're out here to put people at ease with the truth of what the gospel says, what Paul says in Galatians chapter 3, verse 28 and 29, that if you are of Christ, then you are of Abraham's seed. And he made no distinction between man, woman, you know, slave or slave owner, you know, rich or poor, so on and so forth, you know, Greek, Jew. So, you know, we're here to, we're here to shut down some of these false doctrines that are being purported by some of these groups, but also to, at the same time, encourage those who are a little bit confused, maybe even scared to discuss these things with Hebrew Israelite groups. Maybe they're not even knowledgeable about some of the things that they say. And let them know that we can be, I believe that we are being used by God as an outlet for people who just don't know what sources to go to defend the faith or to defend the faith against specific teachings such as that which comes out of some of these Hebrew Israelite groups. So
I guess that's pretty much it.
Yeah, and I'm pretty sure, you know, other members of the team want to say a few things about that. Like, let's go to the G-Man. Yeah, G-Man, like, what is the agenda? What are you trying to expose or reveal when it comes to Hebrew Israelites?
I'm not really sure how much time I got to talk about that, but there's a lot of things I want to expose. For starters, I want to expose their false teachings regarding the gospel, their lies about having to know your identity as well as keeping the law, statutes, and commandments. I mean, I don't know their derogatory comments they make about women and the women's role in the home. I mean, just yesterday I was correcting Ringo, what's his name, Ringo TV Raw, about how to conduct himself around women. I want to correct these guys, and I want to win some of these guys to Christ. I want to expose these guys and take away their influence in our society. I want people to know and to be equipped on how to deal with the Hebrew Israelites, because not everybody knows how to do that. And when people see somebody like myself do it, Vekel do it in person, or Vocab Malone, or Marcus, or Sister Cherry, or any of us, I want people to know what to say, how to say it, and to be able to take away their influence in society. There's a lot of things that expose on these people. These people, a lot of the people that call themselves Hebrew Israelites, need to study. They need to stop listening to their leaders and study. They need to read the Bible for themselves, and they need to learn some proper exegesis, learn the definition of words. And I think that a lot of these people, when they start doing that, you know, they'll be able to know Jesus Christ for real.
All right, let's go to G-Con. That G-Con.
Pose that question again for me. I can't say. I'm sorry.
Yeah, what is your agenda? Like, what are you trying to reveal or expose when it comes to the Hebrew Israelites?
Right. Me being a former Black Hebrew Israelite, I came up out of it, I want to say 2001, and started in it when I was 16 years old. And so one of the things that I realized is the stronghold that it has is it is Satan uses it as a tool of a black supremacy type of tool, a fleshly type tool. I had so much hatred towards every other culture of people, so I think that for the most part, my agenda is to basically get people to, to walk in the spirit of God, because God is a spirit, and for them to understand that if you're living by naturalistic or natural means and, looking at people's color or, how they feel they should wear this or their mannerism and this and that, then it's a problem with that. The scriptures is clear that God doesn't view people like that, so we shouldn't view people like that as well. And a lot of false doctrine is in the Black Hebrew Israelite community. I'm definitely exposing that doctrine. And not only that, I deal with the conscious community just as well. So this is not just the agenda on them, but the agenda on anyone teaching the false a false way. So that's my whole premise right there. Marcus said a handful of things just as well for us. What's concerning the law, covenant, contract, which deals with terms, conditions, and penalties. These guys don't understand the simple things, but deal with these covenants every day or contracts every day within their daily life. So that's my whole thing, man, with dealing with that. Not saying that if you're practicing and you're keeping Hebrew culture, there's nothing, wrong with it if you're keeping it to the point to where you're doing it how Christ, wanted to be kept. Or if you're a former, or if you're an Israelite to just deal with the Old Testament, but for the most part, we know that you got to come through Christ. So, that's my whole thing.
All right, Sister Sherry, want to answer the question?
Okay, can you give me that question again, please?
All right, what is your agenda when it comes to, exposing the Hebrew Israelites? What is your agenda?
Okay, my agenda is pretty much the same as my brothers have told before, is to expose the lies twisted thing they got going on with the Bible, saying, oh, well, you know, salvation is only for Israel and that's it, you know, and everybody else, well, you're doomed. No, that's not true. So that's one of the main agendas, and to let them know who Christ really is, you know, and basically to set straight what has been twisted. So that is basically not just my agenda and not just SOG's agenda, that's God's agenda. A lie has been set out there. A lie has been told on the Father, and we are one of the ones here to call out, cry aloud, and say, no, you're wrong, and to give biblical correction, give mental correction, and give heart correction. And we do it with clarity and conviction, and we do it bold. So that is our main agenda, to set the record straight that Christ came here for all and that salvation is for all who wants it. And whoever doesn't like it, that's your own personal problem. But we'll set you straight too. So that's my answer to that question.
They would see So Real. You want to answer that question?
Sure. You know, basically, I've been, if anyone looks at my YouTube channel, they'll see that for years I've been, you know, really just trying to expose in different ways, you know, which is, you know, what does the Bible say about whatever it is that the Israelites are touting on about? You know, I made a great series called God and the Gentiles. I mean, that's like the best series I've ever made. I've also done, you know, The Comforter Refuted. All kinds of things that I've showed to expose these things. But for right now, as of recently, I've been taking a different in trying to, what I'm trying to expose to the Black Hebrew Israelites, because I'm a historian and a bit of a theologian, but I'm mainly like a real historian. And really, I'm trying to expose that everything that they have is really nothing new, where I'm slowly going to create a series where I'm going to show that the Black Hebrew Israelites, how they, you know, when they kicked off in the 1960s about Jacob and Esau and everything else, how that was actually, you know, conjured up by earlier Christian identity movements. The Christian identity movement came in the 1930s with, you know, the Ku Klux Klan and the skinheads that came up, all that stuff. They actually had things where it was, they had Cain and Abel, Jacob and Esau, Adam and the pre-Adamic beast. Those kind of analogies came from them. You know, that's why you actually have, you know, those kind of sermons called What Happened to Cain, or the Cain Satanic Seed Doctrine. That came from Bernard Lewis Cambret from 1901 and 1983. That's the time he lived. And the Christian identity movement in itself was a breakoff from British Israelism, which started in the 1700s, and to be technical, it really kind of kicked off in 1640. And, of course, that was all about the elect of God and the non-elect of Satan. But they never carried this kind of idea that much about Cain and Abel. But they did carry this idea about the two seeds, where you could look at that, where Daniel Parker published a pamphlet called The View of the Two Seeds. And so you could just go further back and show how a lot of this stuff kicked off with, you know, the Millerites. And when the Millerites ended up being wrong about their predictions about the end of days, they said, there's one way I believe that we could kind of make sure that we do things better at the end of days. They said, maybe we have to keep the Sabbath. They started getting in the covenants. The reason why they did that was because really the Protestants really started going over at that time into Jerusalem to try to go ahead and, you know, do some missionary work over there. And when the missionaries came back, they said, we need to learn Judaism. And that's where that kind of idea came from, about this, you know, Jewishifying of Christianity in the American West. And that's the reason why you had these sacred name movements and all these other things that broke off with the Seventh Day Adventists. You know, that idea was started to be germinated with the return of these missionaries from the 1700s, when they went over and tried to actually, you know, you know, do some missionary work in Judea, you know, and that's the reason why all these things that they do
can actually be seen through the Armstrong movement, you know, and how that died out. But yet they say the very same thing. But today they call themselves Hebrew Rooters. But you look at 119 North Ministries and everybody else, and they continue to say that, yeah, the 12 tribes of Ephraim are the Americans. Who said that? Armstrong. Who did Armstrong get it from? The British Israelis. All these things go back. And as recently, check my video on Session 5 of Christian Hebrew Dialogues. I was talking at the very end of the video with a very good friend of mine. I won't put his name out there, but I put up the 12 tribes chart from the Israelites and the 12 tribes chart by Yair Davidi. And yes, it was a white version. He said he's seen it before, but he said he doesn't understand where it kind of came from. And so ideas, especially theological ideas, just don't come out of nowhere. So they're not getting their theology from the Bible. They're getting it from, you know, all kinds of earlier cults that came about. The best that they can do is just say, well, maybe they were just off. They had the right idea. They just had the wrong people. Well, once again, history, especially the early church fathers, are completely empty of whatever people from the 1640s were touting around. That's a problem. So that's what I'm pretty much trying to do. I don't know when those video series will come out. Now I'm trying to be long-winded. That's all I got to say.
All right. We're going to go to Vocab Malone, and after that, we're going to pretty much go to the audience out there. I see a few people pressing number one. Again, y'all can call in. We do not screen calls. We do not screen calls at this point. Only thing that I ask is when you call in, please keep it professional. You know, we have people listening with the kids and even the elderly. So when you call in, no foul language, you know, you can ask your questions. It's all good. Again, the number is 319-527-6239. If you're shy, you don't want to call, you can send me an email at debatetalkforyou@gmail.com, and I'll definitely read out your question to the panel. And, of course, the chat room is open. The chat room is officially open. If you want to gain access to the chat room, you have to go directly to the Blog Talk Radio website, www.blogtalkradio.com/debatetalkforyou. Click on the show, the hot seat, and you can type in your question in the box, and I'll read your question to the panel of Vocab. You can go ahead.
Yeah, I try not to use the word exposed too much, especially if we just use the term Hebrew Israelites, so-called, although that can be appropriate in some cases. So here's what I mean. If you're talking about One Westers, those whose ideological forebears are from the One West school, it is true exposed is probably the best word because of all the doctrines that have come out of there from the various offshoot camps and sects that are the most damaging and the most unbiblical. But nonetheless, we don't just want to expose, of course. We want to help people understand the doctrines, and that actually takes a lot of time, not only to learn but to explain to people who really ain't in the mix on this stuff, to explain the doctrines because they're so idiosyncratic. Look up the word idiosyncratic. It doesn't mean idiotic, so everyone understands what I'm saying. It just means highly nuanced and really irregular in a capricious kind of way. But the doctrines are so highly idiosyncratic and subjective based upon a lot of personal subjective interpretation that it takes a lot of work to even explain to people what the different One Wester groups believe. Now, when we flip over to those who identify as Hebrew Israelites who are more from places like Israel of God in Chicago, or my man Zadok and Buffalo and groups like that, I do want to have dialogue with those groups and those men and women. And I do want to have some discussion that hopefully leads to some course correction. Now, it may be presumptuous to say, I can understand how it sounds, but when I say course correction, I mean a lot of course correction and some of the errors that are still present in the non-One West Hebrew Israelite type groups. They're not as egregious, and indeed, I do count some of those brothers and sisters as brothers and sisters in Christ, no doubt, meaning they're actually regenerate. They've been given a new heart, but there's some things I think we got to work out and talk about. But when you talk about One Wester groups, I still believe we can have calm discussions and peaceful dialogue. Nonetheless, the doctrines are so backwards a lot of times that we really got to refute it to defend the gospel, and that's really – what the main goal or agenda, if you want to put it that way, is that I have is this: to again make the main thing And the main thing is the most important thing. And I'll close with a scripture that explains exactly what I mean. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you. So first of all, the apostle is saying, I'm going to remind you of something I've already told you. And that word gospel in Greek is euangelion. So the euangelion is important. He's already preached it, and he needs to remind them of it again, which you received, in which you stand. So how do you stand? You don't stand by keeping feasts, although that's fine if you want to do that. You stand by holding to the gospel. Verse 2, and by which you are being saved. That is how a person is made right with the creator of the universe, by believing and living out the gospel. Verse 2 continues, if you hold fast to the word I preach to you, unless you believed in vain. Verse 3, and here's the reason why I'm reading this. This is the part that says what I want to bring out. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received. Then he goes on to talk about Christ being dying for our sins according to scriptures, being buried, being raised, and appearing. But let me stop right there just for a second. It says first importance. Now, that word first is protos. Protos, that's the Greek word there. And if you look it up in different lexicons, it says some interesting things. It'll say, for example, looking at just Strong's, for example, the most imminent, important, the first, the front, or the first in rank and value. It says things like that. And for a more expansive lexical entry, go to Lonida. But the point is, protos is the euangelion. The most important thing is the gospel. And the great concern we have is that the gospel, number one, is not preached. The gospel, number two, is not understood when it's heard. Number three, if the gospel is in the mix in any way, it's left in the dust. It's no longer the first thing. It's kind of like gets a head nod, but then we move on. And so that is a great concern, because otherwise men and women have no way to be righteous in front of a God who is righteous and indeed judges the ungodly. The only way we can be righteous is to have the righteousness of Christ imputed on our behalf, which is 2 Corinthians 5:21 and a whole bunch of other scriptures. And if we do that, we are standing in the gospel by which saves us. And so that's a concern of ours when dealing with the camps, especially the One Westers.
All right, people, this is my favorite part of the show. We go into the phone lines. We're going to hear from the listening audience out there. You know, and again, you know that number, 319-527-6239. For those that's on social media land, if you want to call in, feel free to do so. Again, we do not screen calls at this portion of the show. Anybody can call in. Again, all you got to do is keep it clean, keep it professional, and we'll allow you to ask your questions on the phone lines. And, of course, being that we have so many members of the team, once the question is asked, you know, anybody, you know, from the team can answer the question. But, you know, just allow everybody to, you know, say their piece, I guess, on the team, you know, give me, you know, turns to answer. But let's go to the first person there. Let's go to the first person. Let's see. Let's go to 504-485. You're live in air.
Hi, 504. Sorry, I was
going on?
Yeah, I just have a couple of quick questions. I just want to say peace to all the brothers on the panel. Can any Israelites join the Soldiers of God?
Yeah, if you can find any who are believers in Christ.
Well, okay. I was just wondering. And also, my other question was, because sometimes I'm confused by your guys' mission. Do you guys believe that so-called black people are not Israelites, or do you believe that they are, you just don't believe their doctrine? Because sometimes it gets kind of, you know, mixed up, you know. Sometimes it sounds like you guys are against the doctrine, and then sometimes it sounds like you're just against the lineage, because those are two totally different things. So I just kind of wanted to get your take on that.
I think our focus is not the lineage of any given person. And so we think that discussion can be had because it does touch on key historical things and issues related to identity that can be important, so we're not afraid to have the discussion. However, I think the important thing that we want to reiterate in any situation is whatever the person's ethnic background, if they're not in Christ, they will meet the doom reserved for all sinners. And so an Israelite who truly is ethnically Israel in some way, they have to bow the knee to Christ as Lord, or they will experience his wrath and judgment as we see him coming back in the book of Revelation. And so our key focus is not necessarily on that issue as much as it is, okay, hypothetically, if a person was an Israelite, what are they doing with the Christ? What's their perspective, stance? What's their relationship to him? Because it should be one of submission where he is viewed as Lord. And if it's not, the person cannot rely on their ethnic identity to save them. And so that's a problem. I would say that's the main focus. I don't know if everyone has perfectly agreeing ideas on, like, who is Israel and who's not in the crew, but I just want to at least say I know that's our priority. I'll let someone else speak from that point.
Right. Right. Well, I did hear the brother so real.
Well, hold on. Let somebody,
and, you know,
let somebody else answer on the team that one particular question. Anybody else on the team? Anybody could chime in. Anybody else on the team?
I'll go ahead and answer. I'll be really short. I'll go and answer. Basically, he asked, are we against the idea that the lineage of African Americans in America are Israelites? Is that what you asked?
Right. Do you believe
that?
Yeah, right.
Right. Okay. So now I can only speak for, you know, myself. You know, I can't speak for the entire group because, you know, I don't know where they're all at with that. But as far as I'm concerned, I am against it because, you know, I often ask a lot of Israelites this on off-air phone calls. I ask them all the time. And even in my session, even in my, you know, my Christian and Hebrew sessions, right now we're on session 5, I often ask them, what is an Israelite? Like, what is a Jew? What is a Hebrew? You know, what is it? And, you know, they tell me, you know, it's a race, and then others say it's a bloodline. And I always tell them that every time I look in the Old Testament, I always see, you know, lineage being used for the kings and for the Levites, who were the priests. That's it. Everybody else, I don't see it. You know, you become a Jew or an Israelite, fill in the blank, by circumcision. That's been just rampant throughout the Old Testament and especially in the New Testament. And so if the Jews are not a race, then they are not a lineage either, because if anyone can join that lineage through circumcision, then what do you do? And, you know, if I had a segment right now where I could just go throughout Africa to Timbuktu, which is a book by Rudolf Wenzler, he destroys that notion that, you know, the Jews were just in Africa just ceremonially pure and they just didn't amalgamate with anybody. Not so, but if you want quotes from that later on in the program, I can show you, you know. But yeah, that's my whole thing, that the people here in America are not the Jews. Now, if they go ahead and become circumcised and place themselves under the law of Moses, then yes. Outside of that, no, they're not.
Right, right.
Somebody else was going to say something, I thought.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like.
Yeah, this is Brother Mark. What I would say to that is, I understand, number one, I understand, you know, the reasonings behind why this is such a sensitive topic, you know, of, you know, are the black people Israelites, this, that, and the third. But me personally, you know, I basically had to dismiss this thing, this notion, simply because there really is no way you can actually prove that you're an Israelite. You know, I've been a part of the movement for 7+ years, and after reevaluating the scriptural basis that I had, you know, and the historical basis that I had, I realized that there was really nothing concrete to validate that. It was simply something that it was an idea that I gravitated to because it felt good. The fact that I was told that I was, you know, God's chosen, this, that, and the third.
You know what I'm saying? But other than that, proving that you're initial, there's no way you, there is no DNA test that you can, that you, that a lot of the brothers that do claim that they're Israelites, they don't take DNA tests to prove that. There is no way to validate that. There is no genealogical record that they have to validate that. So to me, it doesn't, you know, it doesn't hold any weight. And especially the scriptures that they use to try to justify their idea, you know, like they'll use certain color scriptures and stuff like that. Those things are easily refutable, you know, but you have brothers who, you know, use those things like Jeremiah 14 and 2 and all the other scriptures, Joel 30 and 30, to basically say, see, brothers, the Israelites were black. And that to me is not proof. That's not proof. You know, that right there isn't sound doctrine. So I'm not completely against it. It's possible. It could be a possibility. I'm not, you know, if I'm an Israelite, so be it. What does that have to do with the gospel? You know, as far as, you know, what do the scriptures, does that mean I'm saved because I'm an Israelite? Absolutely not. You know what I'm saying? So,
well,
to me, it's not really, to me, it's not really a top priority. And I don't support it based off of the information that has been presented thus far.
Right.
Yeah, if I
right.
may say something.
Please, go ahead.
Is that?
Yeah, real quick. I take a slightly different position, but not that much different from what just Marcus just stated. I also agree that there is no way scientifically possible that anybody can prove that they're biologically related to Jacob or any of his 12 sons. However, I'm totally personally, I'm fine if a person wants to consider themselves an Israelite. However, if they're going to be dogmatic about it, then they're going to have to find ways to provide evidence of that. And if it is going to get in the way with the goal of the group, you know, then, yeah, we do have a problem. Even within our group, SOG, we have different ideas on how salvation is attained, and that's on a non-essential area. But we can still fellowship with each other as you know, as we're blood brothers and sisters and stuff like that, and there's no problem. So I would say that if a person wants to consider themselves an Israelite and they want to join our group to expose the false teachings that are coming out of some of these radical movement, branches of the Hebrew Israelite, I would say fine. Just as long as they submit to Christ totally, that Christ is the way, the truth, and life, that he's the only way, that it's not through works, so on and so forth. So, but if they want to call themselves an Israelite, personally, I don't see what the big deal is. But that's just me.
Right. Yeah. Like I don't look at anyone. I don't count you as my enemy, Brother Gideon. The fact that you identify as an Israelite, you know, I just wanted to share, you know, my position on do I agree with it or you know, where do I stand on that. I wanted it to be known that, you know, from my position, I just don't think that there's, you know, the evidence has not been provided to validate, especially scriptural evidence. You know, that has not been provided.
Right. Well, I definitely do believe, you know, we can definitely move in love together, but, you know, when it's time to, you know, reason over these things, we do have to make truth be known. I do feel that those camps is doing a lot of damage, you know, and it's evident with our two brothers, you know, yourself and the brother G-Con, because it can get people to a point to where they don't want nothing to do with it. But I do feel that it is important that it is known who is Israel, because Yahshua says salvation is of the Yuhadim. And I feel what he means by that is that it's going to take the children of Israel to show the world how to come to him so we can experience that grace. So, I mean, you know, y'all brothers be blessed, and, you know, y'all be blessed, man. Thanks for the
Let me respond to that real quick, because I know y'all need to go over there, get on over there to G Consciousness Live and watch how I spank Brother Gideon over there talking about that Hebrew Israelite mess, talking about that you need to be Israel to get the word out. Just like if I'm running a race, right, and I got a message that I got to get across, right, then I quit running. Hey, God not going to stop there. He's going to spread his word to somebody that want to teach it, somebody that loves him, someone that want to do his instructions. So you don't have to go through no Israelite to be saved. I mean, I can go, I'm not an Israelite, you know what I'm saying? And the Israelite didn't come and preach to me to get me saved. So, you know, it's about having the Spirit of God who gives you the ministry of reconciliation. And this is how we walk around with the Spirit of God, and we reconcile people with God, with the Word of God, that the Spirit of God give us remembrance of and His Word that bears witness of the Word, the Spirit of God. So, I mean, you know, it's not about you coming through an Israelite. I mean, salvation did come from the Israelites, but once you get the Spirit of God, you go into the world, you preach it, you teach it. And the Bible was clear that he said the kingdom of God should be taken away from them and given to a nation bringing forth the fruits. What fruits is he talking about? Fruits that Israel did not have. The majority of them fell. And we're not boasting in that. Thank God, you know, and we pay homage to those that kept the fort up. But for the most part, the baton has been passed. We are laborers just as well, you know, to those that are going to do it. You know, Israel ran. And we're running with Israel. We're co-laborers, we're fellow heirs with Israel to those that are in Christ. If you're not in Christ, we're not rocking with you. You know what I'm saying? The Holy Spirit is not coming to tell you that you're an Israelite. That's first of all, because he said, I know that you are Abraham's seed, but you seek to kill me. So it don't matter if you're Israel or not. He's not coming to tell you that. He's coming to get your spirit rejuvenated, and it's not by saying I'm woke because I'm an Israelite. So bottom line is, you know, I've dealt with that teaching before. And it's a false teaching. You know what I'm saying? You don't know if you Israelite. I was a blood because I got put on to be a blood. I'm not false flagging nothing. I never false flagged nothing that I didn't get put on to be one. You don't have no genealogy chart or none of those things, and you're claiming that you're Israel. God scattered many of the nations just like he scattered Israel out of their land. And he brought them back to their land just like he's going to bring Israel back to their land. And some of those people never came back to the land. So with that being said, that's folly. You know what I'm saying? If you is an Israelite, or you say you is an Israelite, yeah, you can join. We have no problem with that. As long as you, as Vekla said, teaching the word, believing on God, the Spirit of God, and you walking by the Spirit in God's ways. And that's it. You're not color banging.
Amen.
Yeah, I'm going to let you respond, but I just want to let y'all know, listen, we 51 minutes has already passed, and we didn't even get to the audience yet. We only got one caller, so we definitely going to go past the 60-minute mark. You know, I apologize. You know, there's a lot of special guests on the panel. I just want to ask y'all, do y'all want to go and take some, because we have a line of people lined up waiting to ask questions right now, but we're close to the 60-minute mark. Do you want to extend the time? Are you guys cool with that?
Yes.
So we can extend the time? Okay. Okay, not a problem. So we're gonna get to y'all out there. I see a lot of people out there standing by. We're gonna get to the audience. But was that so real? You want to say something? Yes.
Oh no, I didn't want to say anything. I just said amen to what everyone said.
Okay. Yeah, somebody wanted to say something. I heard somebody say something. Okay. Anyway,
no, I was just saying yes. I was just saying yeah, let's extend it.
No, it was just an amen.
Yeah. All right, cool. All right, so let's go to the next person. Like I said, anybody could call in. You know that number, 319-527-6239. You're now listening to Debate Talkie Radio. This is the Hot Seat segment. We're going to extend the time so we can try to get as much people as possible to ask their questions. Again, no foul rooms. Keep it clean. Keep it professional. Let's go to the next person. Let's go to 813-240. You're live on the air.
Peace, Sal. How you doing?
Hey, what's good, my brother?
How you doing? Hey, what up, So Real? What up, G-Con, Sister Sherry, G-Man, Vocab Malone?
Hey, what's going on, Chris? I know that number.
Peace, Chris.
What's up, man?
Peace, brother.
What's going on? Hey, look, I just wanted to call and tell everybody, hey, just because we agree on different philosophies and or we may have different faiths, don't mean as a people that we can't get along and continue to love each other as a nation of people. And with that being said, I want to tell G-Man, keep banging on them wicked-ass some wicked ass camps out there. Sister Sherry, keep on helping everybody.
Yeah, keep
for
it clean,
real. I love you,
Chris.
Thank you.
Gotta keep it clean, Chris. Gotta keep it clean, Chris.
Did I cuss? I'm sorry.
Hey,
I'm sorry.
Yeah,
oh,
man.
Forgive me. I'm sorry. Ooh, audience, forgive me. I didn't even know I cussed. I'm sorry. Okay, sorry about that. That's how them camps make me feel sometimes. I'm sorry. Forgive me. But so real, just want to tell you a personal, I love you, Sister Sherry. Keep helping the sisters out there dealing with them wicked camps. Vocab Malone and the other brother, I don't know you, but if you ask so real, he could tell you that I'm a good guy. Me and him talk a lot. And I want to ask G Khan, do he want to have on his station an Isaiah 53 part 2?
Yeah, definitely. We can do that. You know, I'm definitely about that. Isaiah 52 or Isaiah 53? You want 52?
Isaiah 53. We could do 52 if
okay.
You want, but I've been getting a lot of phone calls about it, and they want to hear a part two about it. I don't know if you want to do it on Sal format or your format or So Real's format, but like I said, I know a lot of people wanted to continue to hear it because they was learning on both sides.
Yeah, we definitely can bring it out about Isaiah 53. You know, I think that was a great dialogue, great discussion. So I'm definitely up for that. You know, just let me know when you want to do it, whether or not if we're doing it on Sal or, you know, whatever we do it at. That's, I'm up for that.
Okay, now my question to all of you would be, do you agree that Israel, all things must be fulfilled until Israel returns until Israel returns home? All the prophecies
must
be fulfilled.
I definitely agree.
Okay, so do you all agree that the people there aren't really Israel? Do you agree with that?
Well, I kind of disagree with that dealing with my eschatology, but go ahead, brothers.
Okay,
yeah,
because the book of
Heath, as far as I'm going with that is I believe that some of the Israelites that we see in the nation of Israel are Israel. I know everybody in SOG don't necessarily agree on this, but I have my reasons based on history and based on Bible prophecy. That's all I'm going to say about that.
Okay, so
yeah,
I
wanted to say as well, I do believe that those people there are Israel, but I'm not going to limit them just to that land alone. I do believe that there are just, you know, other Israelites that are out there, especially if you go ahead and join Israel and put your life under the law. But one thing I find interesting is that, you know, throughout history, why is it that all these other groups, whether they're, you know, there's certain Seventh-day Adventists or even certain British Israelis, Christian identities, Hebrew rooters, you know, there's just all these other groups that actually do say, well, you know what, we're either the scattered part of that tribe or we're actually the real Israelites. Why is that narrative coming in out of nowhere? Not out of nowhere. Why is that narrative coming in so late?
Are you asking me that question? Because I don't know.
Yeah.
And I really don't care. I really don't know and don't care why that's coming out.
I think you
really
should look
don't
into
focus
that.
My faith on that. Yeah. You know, I really don't focus my faith on that. But what I wanted to go to was in the book of Hebrews, it said that we were under the covenant of Jeremiah 31. So I wanted you all to expound, how can we be under that covenant when the other prophecies that are contained within that covenant have not been fulfilled? I'll hang up. I'll listen to you guys answer. I want to tell all you guys I love you. And keep doing what you're doing. Peace.
Well, I mean, you have to point to one of them. I mean, that you're saying it weren't fulfilled, because then we'll just be doing guesswork at what we think you're pointing at.
Well,
you
actually,
know?
I know exactly. I know what he's talking about, actually.
Okay.
And, you know, and I think that for the New Testament and also for the Old Testament, it's clear when you deal with the Old Testament in the book of Isaiah and also Jeremiah 31, we see that Christ at one time, or the Mashiach, will come upon an ass or a colt. And then we see also in Daniel, he comes back to where he's glorious and the Father gives him the kingdom, you know. And so I think that what we see is that at one part of time, Daniel says that he was cut off, but there were six things that he must do before he was cut off concerning Israel and the people. And so when we look at the covenant, right, the covenant was something that will be established to the people. And as we see that, you know, his blood was shed, right? Now, on a spiritual, because he is a priest, his blood was shed on a spiritual side. Now, him coming back as the king and coming back, you know, in the book of Daniel, he comes back with judgment. He comes back with, with this this kingship type of attitude, whereas when he wrote on the coat of ash, he came as a humble individual because he was getting ready to shed his blood. So I think that when you look at the covenant in Jeremiah 31, it has been partially fulfilled because Israel rejected it and cut off that king. So when they cut off him, which he was supposed to be cut off because his blood was supposed to be shed as an innocent blood being shed pertaining to the sins of the people as well as the world. So when we look at that, it's just stating there that this is something that has partially been fulfilled. But when Israel, as the scripture says, when he will bring them into the wilderness, I believe it's in the book of Ezekiel, he will bring them in the wilderness and speak softly unto them to bring them into the bonds of the covenant. So they have to be brought into the bonds of the covenant because they rejected it, and they also, cut them off. And Isaiah 53 pertains to what we was talking about. He was cut off from the land of the living, but most of the prophets was killed by Israel. So Israel cut them off. They cut their priest off, their king and their prophet off. So I just wanted to bring that out. It's been partially fulfilled. There is a remainder of that fulfilling that will be established, which will bring Israel into the fold, as well as the New Testament also bear witness to that.
Yeah, this vocab real quick, let me piggyback on what LeBron just said. I think he's probably getting that Romans 9 through 11 with the last thing he said there. But we got to remember that in Luke chapter 22, verse 20, Christ, after they had eaten, took that cup. And what did he say? This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. And so how does Christ establish the new covenant? Well, Hebrews 13 actually answers that question. In Hebrews chapter 13, verse 20, it says this. This is the benediction of the letter. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant. So the covenant has been established by the death of Christ, and that's what he's foreshadowing there when he pours out the cup, or when he takes the cup, rather, and he specifically says, the new covenant, my blood, poured out for you. So the eternal covenant has been established, but LeBron's point is valid in that there's a sense of already, not yet. So the covenant that is new has already been established because Christ has already died and risen again, and that's what we're supposed to commemorate when we take of the Lord's Supper. But yet the full ending of it is not yet worked out. All the implications of Christ's death are not yet worked out. That won't happen, of course, until the final kingdom when he returns and establishes that final order. But we are under the new covenant because the death of Christ has already happened, and that's how the eternal covenant is established when you put Luke 22:20 together with Hebrews chapter 13, verses 20 through 21.
Right, and I'm glad you brought that out, Vocab, because I'm glad you brought that out too, Vocab, because the guy, Chris, he doesn't deal with the New Testament, but he reads it, but he deals mainly with the Old Testament. But for those that are out there listening in, they do deal with the New Testament. Vocab right. Just confirmed, a portion of, I left out because I knew Chris only deals with the Old Testament, and I would just want to bring it out to the Old Testament, bears witness also with the New Testament that they're cohesive. You can't separate them, but I'm glad you brought that out, Brother Vocab. I appreciate that.
Works.
Yeah, and also, just to be real quick, because we got to get the other callers, I'm glad that, he really did bring out that very clear theme in the Bible of kind of already and not yet, because, that's what really does play out. Even when Jesus had said, I will not drink the fourth cup of the vine until I come into the kingdom with you guys. I won't drink that cup. And right now, we're still on cup number three, which is his blood. Can still all drink from that. But when he drinks from the fourth cup in his kingdom, that's it. The time is up. It's over. So we're still open in this gap. And that's the reason why, when Peter asked him, he said, listen, when are you going to bring in the kingdom? He said, it's not time for you to know. But yet at the same time, things really do end up getting fulfilled. I can't fully explain this yet, but, you know, I do strongly believe that that day of Pentecost was, you know, the day where you did have a whole lot of Jews from all over the world come back to Jerusalem together, which is the reason why James writes to the 12 tribes scattered abroad, and why Paul says in the book of Acts, where he, you know, he says that he knows that the 12 tribes are, you know, worshiping the Lord day and night. They wouldn't be talking like that if, you know, if they really weren't around or if they weren't back. You know, so I'm sorry, history really isn't so cut and dry sometimes, you know, and I think it's really like that for reasons that I haven't really, I'm still kind of studying to understand myself. But that's the best that, you know. That,
hey, it's interesting, you know, you said that. I'm just saying words. All right. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, man. Sorry about that. We got some people standing by. We have a lot of callers standing by. You know that number. Put it on speed dial, 319-527-1639. You can call on via phone, via Skype. We got to press number one. We'll add you to the conversation. But we have a line of people that have questions. Let's go to the phone lines. Again, got to keep it clean, keep it professional if you're new to the show. Let's go to 404-788-LIVE-AND-AIR.
Hey, how you doing? This is Swarzman. What's going on to the panel? How's everybody?
What's going on, priest? Peace, brother.
Hey, how you doing?
Hey, what's good, Omar?
Okay. Hey, sis, how you doing? Yeah, I just wanted to say this, right? Now, you know me, I'm an Israelite to death. But even in my paradigm, I found flaws. I found flaws. And that's why, you know, I roll with the shutdown crew and we go in this Bible. Okay, but I want to say this. I got a hard question, and I would like you guys to answer it with no philosophical answer, with a precept. Now, I'm going to show a flaw in your doctrine. In that doctrine, it says that if you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you are saved. Matter of fact, I just heard LaRon say he's saved. Now, I want y'all, anyone of y'all, can, whoever you, I want you to answer this for me, right? Here it is. This is St. John 6, starting at 64, says, but there are some of you that believe not. And this will have the mouth of Christ. For Jesus knew from the beginning who they were that believe not and who shall betray him. Then it says, and he said, therefore said I unto you that no man can, it says that no man can come unto me except it were given unto him of my Father. So this is what Christ said. You can't even come to him unless it's given from the Father, meaning it got to be preordained. But according to your doctrine, if you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior, you're saved. So there's a contradiction. Now let me read on. Then it says, from that time, many of the disciples went back, then it says, and walked no more with him. When he dropped that, many of his disciples didn't walk with him no more. Now check this out. Let's continue. Then it says, then said Jesus unto the 12, will ye also go away? He asked his 12 disciples, will you also go away? So this is proven that if you, that doctrine, that's a flaw. You teach people that if you accept that Jesus Christ is your Lord and personal Savior, you're saved, is a flaw and it's a lie. Because he just told the disciples, would you go away? Then it says, then Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life. Now watch this. And we believe and are sure that thou art the Christ, the Son of the living power. Now watch what Jesus said. Jesus answered them, have not I chosen you 12 and one of you a devil? Then he said, look, I chose 12, but one still was a devil. So I want somebody to answer that for me. Is that a flaw in your doctrine in Christianity that as long as I accept Jesus Christ, my Lord, personal Savior, I'm saved? And can anybody counteract that with a scripture? That's my question.
Yeah, that's a good
I like to go first. Well, I'll tell you what, Vocab, you go first, and then I'll go after you.
Right on, man. Romans chapter 10, verse 9 says, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, thou shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. So saying you're saved is indeed a biblical to use. And the reasons given there is because the person believes and then speaks it. So that's true. Now, you said personal Lord and Savior. I don't use that language because the Bible never talks about personal Lord and Savior. So that's something that's kind of part of evangelicalism, but you will not really hear me using that word personal Savior because it sometimes makes it subjective, but because Jesus is Lord, whether you acknowledge it or not. Now, in the beginning, Brother Vecco mentioned how we have some different views of how salvation works itself out. We all believe that you're saved by grace through faith, apart from works, so that no one may boast, is strictly Christ's righteousness. However, we do have some differences in how we believe that all works out in relationship to man's will and God's sovereignty. So when you talk about John chapter 6, verse 37, and all of that, verse 44, that's actually music to my ears. I'm Reformed, and so under Reformed soteriology, the belief, and I believe it's a biblical one born out of the text, is that only those ordained to eternal life will be the ones who do the believing. And so it is true that people believe because they have the desire to believe. The question is, why do they have the desire to believe? That's a sovereign work of the Holy Spirit upon the heart, according to Ephesians chapter 1, the election that was worked out before the foundation of the world was laid because he predestined us for adoption as sons in his love. And so when we put all that together, I actually agree with the statement that it is only those whom God chooses. However, he doesn't choose them because he knows they're going to choose him or because he knows they're going to work righteousness. He chooses them according to his own will and his own plan. Again, going back to Ephesians 1. But the challenge to the Hebrew Israelite is you can't show us or tell us, biblically speaking, that the elect are only ethnic Israelites. And in fact, it says something very different throughout the New Covenant, and I would even say there's lots of foreshadowings in the Old Testament as well. But I know there may be some different shades on that answer, but what I'm telling you is that you may not be aware that there's some differences in how Christians view some of those aspects. So I don't go against the concept of being ordained to eternal life and that it is ultimately his sovereign choice and we're just recipients of grace. I actually agree with you on that particular point.
Okay, so you technically can't run around telling people they're saved.
No. See, that's now you're going to a different issue. The question is, are we saved because of our will or because of God's will? The question is, to that answer, is God's will. But then if somebody does believe in their heart and speak with their mouth, they will be saved. And so there's a blessed assurance, as the song goes, because if you do that, God is faithful to keep his promises. So if he tells you, if you believe in your heart, and if you speak with your mouth, you are saved, then it indeed is done. And Christ will lose none of those who are his. So first of all, I don't know why you have a problem with the word saved since it's a biblical word. And second of all, if someone shows fruits according to repentance, as the scriptures say, and has done what Romans 10 says, then they are saved. Now, of course, only the Lord knows until the final day. But that does not mean we're not allowed to say you're saved because you see people in the New Testament, you see them talking about being saved, being justified, made right with God. And so there's an assurance there that, for example, the Muslim would never have because they have a capricious God that they don't know. So we don't have certainty on who's saved because we don't have a spiritual x-ray. But to say that nobody's saved and no one can use that language goes against the biblical testimony.
Okay. So do you believe that there are flaws in your ideology? Do you believe that, or your ideology is perfect? That's my question.
No, because that's a different question. And the thing is that your very question that you asked, which you said was a flaw in the ideology, you asked the question based upon a misunderstanding that you had of certain Christian soteriology, meaning you didn't understand Reformed theology. So
yeah,
there's no problem with Reformed theology. The problem is your misunderstanding.
No, listen, you disagreed I was right. So how is that a misunderstanding? Okay, you didn't answer the question. You went around.
No, because you said Christians only say this. But I was telling you, nah, the Christians don't only say this. Here's what they also say. That was my point.
Actually,
so you pointing out the flaw wasn't a flaw in the first place. That's what I'm saying.
But you answered something I didn't ask you about. when I asked you that question about that, which is saying that unless the Most High give the green light to Christ to choose you, you can't run around saying, well, if I'm in Christ, I'm definitely saved. That's the whole premise of that, why I brought that up.
No, those are two different issues. You're putting two different issues together. Oh. It is true that if you confess with your heart and believe, or confess with your mouth and believe in your heart, you are saved. Are you going to deny what's in Romans chapter 10? But the way a person gets there is because of the Father's will. Only those who the Father has given to the Son will come to the Son. But when they come, they are there, and indeed they will be raised up on the last day. So you're putting two different issues. So why? Let me ask, I don't understand. Why are you saying you can't say you're saved when Romans chapter 10, verse 10 says, verse 9 says you are saved if you do these things? Why are you telling people you can't say you're saved? I don't get that.
Well, you can't, first of all, saved is used in two different contexts in the Bible. Because when you go to Luke,
I'm talking about the Romans 10, 9.
Romans 10, 9. What did you say?
Romans chapter 10, verse 9.
Okay.
And I don't understand why you're against that word when there it is in the text. I'm having trouble understanding that.
But I just showed you, listen, did not the disciples confess the name of Christ? Yes or no? Huh? Hello?
Did the disciples confess the name of Christ?
Yeah, when they would follow him, didn't they do it? Didn't they confess the name of Christ?
I imagine they did. They were known as his disciples.
Right. We read in the text when I read it, right? And he turned to them and said, would you leave me? So even though they confessed it, they still had an option. He still told them.
No. Nah, now you're going against your own thing of what you said. Nah, check it out. That's wild.
Again, what I read.
Check this out. No, I'll show you from John chapter 6. This is ironic. You're saying they have an option to leave. You're telling me salvation is preordained, which indeed it is, but now you're telling me they have the option to leave. Now, let me show you that once you're in his hand, no one can pluck you out, which is from John chapter 10. Watch this in verse 37. All that the Father gives to me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never cast out. So, first of all, they're kept in Christ, verse 37. Now, watch this in verse 39. There's a continuous chain from those who believe, those who will be raised up. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. For this is the will of my Father, and everyone who looks on the Son and believes on him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. So those who are given to the Father, or those who are given by the Father, are those who believe, and those who believe will never be cast out. And Jesus says he will lose none of them, and they will all be raised up on the last day. So there's no way a person can take themselves out of the Father's hand once they're in the Father's hand, unless you're going to say, even though Christ says, I will lose none, the swordsman is saying, oh, he's going to lose some? They don't have the option. And Judas was never elect. He was a devil. That's the whole point. He was chosen to be one of the 12, but he was never chosen from the foundation of the world to be adopted. He was a devil.
All right, we got to let two more people respond to that because we got some more callers standing by. Two more people from the team.
I'm
going to
go ahead and skip because we got more callers. Okay. We got more callers. I'm going to go ahead and skip. Just go ahead.
Okay, cool. All right, so let's go to the next person then. Let's go to 757-752, the live and air.
Hey, Brother Sal, this is Eugene, the Truth Seeker. How you doing this evening?
Hey, what's going on, man?
And distinguished panel, how are you this evening?
What up?
What's going on, bro?
All right, how you doing?
I'm doing all right. I got a couple questions.
All
right. First off, what I'd like to know is, do you all consider yourselves Protestants? And if you do, are you familiar with what's going to happen to all the Protestants in this coming October?
I'll answer that somewhat. I consider myself to be a Protestant, and I think everybody else in SOG is a Protestant, as far as I know. And what's going to happen in October?
Well, basically in October is considered the 500th anniversary of Martin Luther's.
Yeah, I've heard about that. Right, I've heard about that, yeah.
Yeah, but basically what you're saying is,
about it. I got God on my back. I got God watching my back, and you know, I got the Holy Spirit watching over me. I'm not worried about what the Roman Catholic Church might try to do. You know, we're going to persecute for our faith anyway, so, you know, I'm not worried about anything.
I would like to hear what
it's good that you. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, go ahead. I'm listening.
No, I'm saying it's good. You know that God has your back, but there's a lot of people out there that they're not aware of what's happening, and I'm thinking that they need to be told to them as to what's happening so they can know, so they can not be deceived. Basically, you know, the one thing Jesus always says, you know, be thou not deceived, or let no one deceive you. So the thing is, what you're saying, what I just put out there, it's already in progress. And the thing is, it's going to come to its fruition on this coming Halloween, which is the anniversary of Martin Luther's protest. Because basically what they're saying is after that, you will no longer be a Protestant. You know, you
I'll
can
like
maybe
talk about that. Since I think I'm the most aggressive member of SOG on this topic with the Roman Catholic Church, I don't care what the Roman Catholic Church says about me being a Protestant or not being a Protestant. I disagree with the doctrines and creeds of the Holy Roman Catholic Church. I am a Protestant believer that believes on Jesus and Jesus alone for my salvation. I don't believe in any, you know, sacraments and the other things that they teach in the Roman Catholic Church. So I don't really care what they say. This Pope that they have right now, Pope, what's his name? Pope Francis, I think his name is. I don't recognize him as some type of authority or anything like that. And in the moment they try to make me look at him as some type of authority, he ain't going to like what's going to come out of my mouth. Now, I'll let the rest of SOG talk, because if I talk too much, you know, I might get kicked off the show.
I guess to keep it real short, you basically asked, like, do we all consider ourselves Protestant? And once again, I'll just have to speak for myself. You know, for me, you know, the answer was yes. But, you know, for the last few years, now my answer is no. And that's just honest, humble studies from what I did years ago when I ended up digging into just like the roots of my faith. And, you know, basically I take a Eastern Orthodox stance. Yes, I go to a Protestant church, and, you know, I love them to death, and I will always, you know, stick by them unless God just leads me somewhere else, you know, because God always has an assignment and a purpose, you know, wherever you are, and you have to be led by him, you know, and it's not just about, oh, I believe this, so therefore I'm going to go there, you know. But, yeah, I mean, when it comes to that, is there any perfect denomination, even though I'm pre-denominational? No, there isn't. There's problems in every church. And this is the reason why I was saying earlier, this means that there's also problems in every Israelite camp, which is the reason why I kept going back to the emphasis that the problem is sin. Because the same things that, you know, whatever it is that, you know, people had left a Christian church for are the same issues that arise in Israelite camps, whether it be money or little finance stuff going on, or, you know, sexual immorality or little pedophilia stuff going on and odd members and stuff. And all of a sudden, you know, we see that the problem is sin. And we keep just overlooking that, you know, and we're trying to, you know, spend the rest of our lives trying to join a perfect church. You won't find it. That's not what, you know, you were never destined to find a perfect church. You know, you're destined to, you know, be Christ to the world as his disciple, you know, and to be a light wherever you are, you know, and to be wherever God leads you. But that's the best I could say.
All right. Let me say this. With me, you know, I used to take the, you know, I know, you know, some of the things that we teach, you know, far as come up out of the Protestant movement. Well, you know, just some of the things, well, I wouldn't say the Protestant movement, because mainly the things that they teach come up out of the Bible. But me personally, you know, I'm not a Protestant, you know, I'm getting to the point to where I don't like the fact that where somebody classify this as this and, you know, whatever the case may be. I'm just a believer. I just want to be called a believer of Christ and a Christian, basically. Something just regular and going by the teachings of the Bible. I don't want nobody to try to get no advantage of me, on me, you know, by saying that I'm some type of Protestant or this and that. Are there things that I believe that's outside of the Bible, just not in the Bible, you know, that on how we explain theology? Yes, but, you know, Protestant is just something that deals with theology, basically, you know, on what people's differences is and the movement to come up out of the Catholic, you know, traditions. And that's cool, but for the most part, man, I'm just regular old LaRon, a believer, you know what I'm saying, in Christ, you know, and that's just it right there with me personally.
Yeah, and if I could think about this topic, about what I mean by being a Protestant, basically what that means is I do not agree with the doctrines and creeds of the Holy Roman Catholic Church, meaning I literally do not recognize the office of the Pope as being anything significant. The Pope, if I met him tomorrow, would be an ordinary man standing before me, and he would be treated like an ordinary man. I wouldn't talk to him like he's anybody important. My pastor would get more respect than he would. As far as their what do you call them, their priest or their nuns or their doctrines, this is about as nice as I can be regarding that, because I don't want to offend nobody, I suppose, because I know what I really want to say. But I just don't recognize it as any type of authority. I only recognize the authority from Scripture and the truth of Scripture. I don't recognize anything from the Holy Roman Catholic Church as being authoritative at all. These people are responsible for killing a lot of people who followed Jesus Christ, you know, back in the day in the early church history, and forced a lot of people to follow their doctrines, or they were killed. And I have a lot, and I mean a lot of things I would like to say about their idolatry, about their mistreatment of their people, the lying, the taxes, they're lying about how long you're going to be in hell and all these other things that I would like to get into. But, again, I like being an SOG, and I don't want to get kicked out because I can be kind of aggressive.
All right, family, we still have a lot of people lined up, ready to ask their questions and their comments. Right about now, it's 9:42. So, of course, soldiers of God, whenever y'all are ready to, you know, stop the clock or whatever, but let me know. But we're going to take a few more of these questions out here. We have a lot of people lined up, ready to ask their questions. And if you're listening on social media, if you're listening on YouTube, some people actually live streaming this particular show, you can call in. Like I said, anybody can call in. That number is 319-527-6239. Let's go to the next caller. Let's go to 929-331. You're live in there.
Peace and love, grace and peace, shalom. This is Neo Saints of Thunder coming at you, Adi Allah. I just want to say a statement. Even though I found out that there was a lot of mistakes in the doctrines that were taught in Israel, I still never stopped believing that we the Israelites. And there's too many things outside of the Israelites that point to that we are the Israelites. Because you got quotes from Malcolm saying that we the lost sheep, we the house of Israel, that we the rejected and despised people, that the Lord didn't despise people. You got Martin Luther King. He said he been to the mountaintop, and we as a people should make it to the promised land. You got many points outside the Israelites that point to that we the chosen people. One thing I see amongst when I came out of the groups back in One West is that all our people is a spiritual people, no matter what denomination or churches that they belong to. But then sometimes I see that a lot of our people is just letting it's like they stuck in that amongst the Israelites. They've been trying to wake them up to their nationality. And even though they're trying to wake them up to their nationality, it seems like that's why over the years the brothers have become so angry because they could lay stuff out in simple terms, and people that are in these different sects and denominations, they make excuses why they don't want to be who they truly are. And no matter what the brothers and sisters or brothers on the panel say, I still see you as an Israelite. Whether you want it or not, or whether you like it or not, you got to have balance. And that's all I got to say.
All right, anybody want to respond to that?
Well,
you can respond, anybody.
Marcus Sebeckel? This is Brother Marcus. I guess my question you mentioned the people earlier, like Malcolm X and Martin Luther King and stuff like that. You know, those men are not, you know, historians or scholars. You know what I'm saying? Like, those men are, if anything, they're more like, political leaders in a sense. You know, but they're not actual scholars. So, I mean, there were things that Malcolm X was into, which, you know, at the end of his day, you know, he denounced. You know what I'm saying? So that doesn't mean just because they said something that it's the truth. You know, we have a lot of leaders like celebrities today who say things, you know, and we know that that's not true. You know, we got different celebrities in the hip-hop industry who ascribe to, you know, Egyptology or Pan-African types of, you know, beliefs and stuff like that. That doesn't make it correct because they ascribe to those things. So that would be my response to that. And then also a question that I wanted to ask you is, what exactly would be I know it, but I kind of just want you to say it, you know, but what do you think is the great significance in basically, you know, coming to the realization that you are an Israelite?
Well, the churches, period, they need their heritage. The churches is rejecting who they are. And that's the bottom line. The reason, of course, if it's left the way it is without our nationality and without our heritage, we're just going to be a divided nation. We are divided as a nation because just for the few minutes, I heard y'all say y'all about Protestants, and y'all not Protestants. You part of the nation of our people because your spirit bear witness that you the nation of the people that the Lord has come to redeem. And you talk about the white Jews in Israel. The white Jews in Israel is not the Jew, and that's been proven over and over again. Everybody knows their history. They came in there through Rothschild money. Everybody knows they're not the Jews. Even the Egyptians know they're not the Jews.
Hey, let me ask a question.
You know, can I say this real quick, Brother Marcus? Just chime in real quick, that, anyone else.
Let me just say this real quick. Yeah.
Okay. No, say it again, Brother Marcus.
No, you know, I did have some things that I kind of wanted to express to him, but, you know, I'm going to let everybody take it off.
Yeah, I'm going to say this real quick, and after that, someone else can just chime in. You know, what I usually do, like I said, I hear everybody out, and then after that, I go and look into the Bible, and I try to find that narrative. And if I can't find that narrative in the Bible, then that means somebody's wrong. The Bible's wrong or the person's wrong. If they're saying that, you know, we're here to wake up, right? We're here to wake our people up. That's their form of evangelism. I don't find that narrative in the Bible. I find that we're to be made alive, right? Ephesians 2:1 says, and you were quickened, you were made alive, right? And why were you made alive? It wasn't because you were asleep, because, you know, that's what they say. Oh, you're asleep, you need to be awake. No, the Bible puts a stronger emphasis. It says, no, you're not asleep, you're dead, and Christ has come to make you alive. So this isn't not, you know, oh, you're asleep and now it's time to wake up. No. Second thing is, I don't see anywhere in the New Testament where they push this kind of thing about nationality. I keep on finding in Timothy and Titus where it says, listen, forget vain genealogies. All it does is make more
gender
questions. And also it just makes more contention. And then he says in Titus, he says, listen, you know, forget about genealogies because, you know, it's fruitless and it's unprofitable. You know, so I don't find that emphasis. For to say that the church is weak because it's denying their heritage, you know, I don't find that narrative in there. I find that our identity is in Christ and we are his bride, the church. I would never give up, you know, being Christ's, you know, bride, you know, as the church for a land on earth. You know, it's almost like Marcus Garvey said, I wouldn't give up a continent for an island. So,
right.
Yeah.
Hey, caller, can I ask you, you do believe it's important for people, if they're a Hebrew, to know they're a Hebrew, correct?
Can I say this? The roots of Christianity come out of the book. The roots of Christianity come out of
the
book of Acts. I'm not changing it.
Oh, good. Well,
yo,
you can ask your question.
If I could ask the caller if he believes it's important for somebody to know they're Hebrew from the people of Israel. He thinks that's an important thing, he said, right? Caller?
Yeah, it is important because that's who it started with.
Can I ask you
The Lord chose that. There's
right.
a difference
then
between white Christianity and black Christianity.
Okay, but a follow-up question to what you just said. If it's so important, why does Paul say in Philippians 3 that I was a Hebrew of the Hebrews from the tribe of Benjamin, but whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. And then in verse 8, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ my Lord. And then he says in verse 9, he counts it as rubbish, which if you look in Greek, the word rubbish there is skubalon. And the word skubalon basically means dung. So you're saying churches are missing out because they're not telling people they're Hebrews and Benjamites and things like that. But why does
you can't admit
God's word
Romans 9 either. You can't get past Romans 9 either.
3. You're saying it's important, but he counts it as lost. Who's right?
Yeah, because he was going to the higher level of the spirit.
He doesn't
all right?
say
he was
that.
Going
he
more
so
into
Christ.
The higher level
no,
of the spirit. That don't mean to be dumb
level.
And don't know who you
combat.
Are. He quoted who he was.
Yeah, and then he says, I count it as loss, my friend. So if he's saying he counts it as loss, as rubbish, as skubalon, why are you saying it's so important on the itinerary? Who's right? Who should we trust? Philippians 3 or caller number 3?
Listen, we got some more callers
like
standing
that.
By.
Yeah, I like that.
We got more people standing by. I got to get to some more of these
like
callers.
That.
Again, you know that number is 319-527-6239. We got to get to the next caller. We got a whole lot of people standing by waiting to ask their questions. Let's go to the next person. Let's go to 706-505. You're live with it.
Yo, what's up? Yo, this is Yehukana Ben Yehuda. What's up, SOG?
You
what
hey, what's
going
on, bro?
Hey, Monty. What's up, Nah? You know, I know these people. You know, hey, what up, vocab? I ain't forgot about you neither. Hey, G-Man. Hey, G-Man, you shorted me, man. You was supposed to talk to me yesterday. You went ahead and did the Ringo thing, but I forgive you for that. It's all love.
I forgot about it. It's all right.
It's all good. It's all
you
good. Now, what I'm going to say is this. Now, you know, all Hebrews don't believe the same. Now, through Mashiach, all can be saved who confess. But this is the thing. The bride is Israel. Those who have confessed Christ, who are Gentiles, can be and will be grafted in to Israel, according to Isaiah 56, and there's other chapters in Ezekiel. Now, So Real and G Conscious, y'all said something kind of contradicting because y'all was asked about the Israelites. Now, you say that nobody can prove that they're Israelites through genealogy and this and that. And you said nobody really knows who are really Israelites and this and that. But then when you came to the white Jews, Surreal, you and G Conscious said y'all believe that they are white Jews. Now, how are they the Jews when they don't even fulfill Bible scripture? They're not even doing what they're supposed to do if they are the real Jews.
I would love to hear
what
you
said before. I'm going to let you guys answer, but let me make a quick clarification. They never said white Jews. They said the people living in Israel. And the people living in Israel include people like the Mizrahi Jews, who are Eastern Jews who never left, who are certainly not white. They don't look like Jerry Seinfeld. They look like their Middle Eastern neighbors. So just a clarification,
okay, well,
they never said white Jews.
Yeah, you're right. Okay, let me be specific. The Ashkenazi Jews. How about that? We're talking about the Ashkenazi Jews. Because they're the ones who run that country.
Hmm. Yeah, can I answer that? Because I talked about this a couple of times on my G podcast. I think that the Nazis, when they were persecuting the Jews over there in Germany, they had a really good system of determining who was a Jew and who was not a Jew. They didn't just look at people physically and say, okay, this person's a Jew. They looked at their family and they looked at their lineage. Now, you can argue about the type of Jews they are to your blue in the face, and that's a discussion for another day. But the point of the matter is that the people that was being persecuted in Poland, the people that was being persecuted in Nazi Germany, and I'm not speaking for no one else, I personally believe those people were Jews, and I believe it was a fulfillment of Bible prophecy when they went back over to the land of Israel and became a nation again. There are some people that don't agree with me, and that's all fine and well. But the point of the matter is I believe that based on Bible prophecy. Can I prove it with DNA or anything like that? Absolutely not. But I can look at Bible prophecy and compare and contrast and come to the conclusion that the Jews that are over there in that are over there in Israel are some of the Jews. I wouldn't say all of them, but they're
I agree with you. Now, some of them are Jews. Some of them are Jews, but I'm talking about what Surreal and G. Concha said. They said nobody can really claim to be true descendants of Jews or any other tribes.
Exactly.
All tribes have been scattered all throughout the world. If you read Ezekiel 36 and 24, he said, it's going to come a time when I call my people from all the countries. So the Jews, there are Hebrews, not Jews. I'm going to say all tribes. There are descendants.
And two things,
descendants to Africa, the descendants everywhere, to the four corners.
Right, and two things, though, because we keep on going in circles with this, especially in session number 5 and session number 2 that we had. I keep on asking you, what makes you a Jew? And every time you concede to the fact that the Old and New Testament shows that by circumcision and placing yourself under the law of Moses automatically takes it outside of the race and lineage category, your question falls apart. Second thing is, again, I've already pointed tonight that everyone really needs to take a deep look at Acts number 2, where you have by the power of the Holy Spirit when he fell at Pentecost, that it had a recording of Jews under every nation under heaven, and it gave this very long list. And I haven't found a list longer than that, I guess, it's maybe since 1948 or whatever. Maybe the 1948 one rivals that one. But, you know, when it comes to Ezekiel 37, you know, that can be looked at as being fulfilled in Acts chapter 2, because when all those Jews came back, that's not something that everyone could just overlook. People need to look deeply into that. You know, I may be wrong in my position, but that's something that really does need to be looked at. But that's
right.
It. So.
Right, and then I want to respond to that, and then I think that it's only fair that the next question that we get Marcus in the mix-up, because I know that he definitely been standing there. He wanted to say something the last thing, and he didn't get to say what he wanted to say. But, yeah, you know, as I stated before, you know, and start dealing with the Jews, you know, there are some Jews, it's definitely, the majority of Jews are definitely scattered, you know, can they know who they are? You know, some of them can due to the fact that they keep the traditions that they kept since they were scattered. You know, that seems to not be the case, but most black Americans that have come to America. Now you have also some Jews that we see this in Ethiopia that are black Jews just as well. You have some white Jews. You have some also Arabic-looking Jews just as well, too, because these people were spread on different continents. But these people keep their traditions, and they have something that bear witness that they are Jews, you know, or that they, you know, have some form of Judaism. And so my thing is this is that, you know, when I study eschatology, I see Christ coming back in Revelations 11. It says that a temple is going to be there.
And there's going to be a national Israel, according to Zechariah chapter 14, when he says he will come and fight against those nations that ravaged those people that's in the city of Jerusalem. And so I know that, you know, that this is a nation that is there. As I studied the Ashkenazi Jews, the Sephardic Jews, the Ethiopian Jews, Mazarim Jews, the Iraqi Jews, these are Jews that you guys missed the history of, that don't know anything about these things, that carried the torch, you know, before there was a Atlantic slave trade, which that history did, Divine Ron Prospect and everybody who says they deal with history seem to skip over that and jump right to the Atlantic slave trade, which I find odd. So these people, they have the writings, they have the all the historical information, they keep their traditions. And then once we go back and we study the history of these people, we realize that these people are really Jews. Just because they have this race descent or they have this color does not necessarily make them not a Jew. Because we know that according to how you guys said, if this person went and had sex with a white woman, then that woman, that white, they produce a child and that child will come out probably as a white descent. Or if that child continues to go and have sex with white women, then you have a whole white race, but descendants of a Israelite. So that's the same thing with the Ethiopian Jews just as well, and also the Iraqi Jews, which we see that these Jews are different colors because they've been spread on different continents. So you have black Jews, white Jews, Arabic-looking Jews, or Asiatic-looking Jews, to say for a better term. So all I'm saying is this is that we know that according to eschatology, that there will be some Jews that will be in that land that will build that temple, according to Revelation 11 and also 2 Thessalonians 2:4-5, when it says that the Antichrist will come in that temple of God and say that he is God. Well, there has to be a temple before he can come in and in that temple, and there has to be some type of political ties and economic ties in order for these things to go about, and religious ties in order for them to build this temple. And that's when we start getting off into these wars and these different things. So I definitely would agree that there are definitely some Jews. Now, is some of the black people of America in America now, some of them Jews? Possibly they can be, as well as on the other islands. But we know that the Ethiopian Jews, those that are in Egypt, Patros, and all of those other areas, according to Isaiah 11, are Jews, because the Bible said they will come from those areas. However, I find it odd that you guys do not mention anything about the other lands that are mentioned in Isaiah 11, when God will regather them, talking about these lands of Iraq and Shinar and these other lands that are you know, in those areas too, as well as around the Mediterranean.
Right.
Yeah, go ahead, Brother Marcus.
Forgive me, y'all. I ended up forgetting the point that I wanted to express to the brother. But to just kind of, I guess, piggyback off of what everyone was saying, you know, I agree with everything that's been brought out. And, as far as, you know, those, because I know, I can kind of assume that the brother does not support the idea that the people in the land today are the Jews. I heard another person also talk about how, what did he say, man? I can't really remember. But he was basically trying to say that they were imposters and stuff like that. They weren't the real Jews. But, you know, I guess the question that I would ask to the audience and stuff out there is, has anyone ever, you know, did any research on the actual DNA studies, you know, that have been done on the different, you know, Jews, like the Ashkenazi Jews, the Sephardic Jews and stuff like that? Because I think it's real interesting, because like when you look at these DNA studies, I got a huge list of them that I'm looking at right now, but for the majority it's like, you know, they conclude that they only have about 30% of European ancestry, you know. And it's like, but then you have on the other end, the people who don't support it at all, they're trying to say, oh, these guys are, you know, pure Europeans, they're not Jews at all, they're imposters. But this isn't what the studies are saying. You know, and then also, like what Laurent stated, What about the customs? You know, where did they get their customs from and things of that nature? You know, where did they learn the language from and stuff like that? Like, you can't gloss over that and ignore that. And then there's also history that a lot of the Israelite groups out there, they don't touch on, like the Bar Kokhba Wars and stuff like that, that took place after 70 AD. I mean, you have Israelite camps who only talking about the year 70 AD, and then they jump to the transatlantic slave trade, which is like 1,500 years later in the sense. And it's like, well, wait a minute, what happened to the history in between that? And, you know, there's history in between that. There's archaeology, you know what I'm saying, that provides us information of the Jews' whereabouts, where they were at, where they relocated, and stuff like that. And you can't ignore that. Like, to me, that just doesn't make sense. How could you say that you love history, or that you're acknowledging history, but you ignore those things? It just doesn't make sense. You know, it's very inconsistent.
I like to add something to this too. I also want to remind the Hebrew Israelites about how they got their revelation that black people are the biblical Jews. You know, they claim that this angel with a perfect afro came into a bar and shared with an individual in the bar that black people are the Israelites. I mean, seriously, I'm not trying to be disrespectful or anything like that, but that's how most cults got started. I mean, if you look at the Muslims, they claim that Gabriel came down from heaven and gave Muhammad some revelation that his thing was right. If you look at Joseph Smith and the Mormons, they claim that some angel came down and told Joseph Smith that he was right. I mean, seriously. You know what I mean? There is absolutely positivity. You can't use that as, like, evidence saying that, okay, so this is why blacks are the Israelites, because some dude with a perfect afro came down from heaven, you know what I mean, and revealed to some dude in a bar of all places that the Israelites were black. I mean, seriously.
Right. The one of the guys said, I talked to the guy over at, I believe it's AOC or AOG or one of the guys. He said that he knew that he was an Israelite. He know that blacks are Israelites because how they play basketball, how somebody can shoot a jump shot or somebody can line up from the three-point line. I said, wow, that's crazy.
That's ridiculous, you know. And, again, you know, my position on the whole thing of, you know what I'm saying, if you're Israel or not, number one, the information that these camps and, you know, the brothers who aren't a part of the camps, but other Israelites out there that they're, you know, bringing out, it's not consistent. It's not proof. You know what I'm saying? So we gotta, if you're gonna claim that, if you want to push that and say that, you know, if you want to push it like it's something that's essential or something like that, then you gotta have more information or something to validate that. I don't really know what to tell you. I'm trying to be as nice as I can, you know, with that, but it's just not working.
Well, can I piggyback off of you, Brother Marcus? This is why for me personally, I do not like this subject, what we're talking about, and so well, and you showed the example so well from the scriptures. But for towards the Hebrew Israelites who go to this particular subject, to make this a big platform, not one time have I heard them expound on Jesus Christ. This is what I'm talking
right.
about. Getting so caught up in nationality, it takes away the focus from Christ. This is why I'd be so ready to really go for your jugular vein. And I have no problem doing it. None of us on this line does. Because literally you're taking the main focus off of Christ. This is what I cannot stand. Go ahead, Marcus.
Right. That kind of reminded me on what I was trying to say earlier. The brother was saying something like, he was saying basically, you know, like the church isn't teaching the nationality. That's what we need. And no, it's not what we need. You know, knowing that we're an Israelite is not what our people need. You know what I'm saying? I mean, look at the camps today. A lot of them know that they're Israel, and they don't even agree. You know, they can't even be in the same building with one another. I mean, I was a part of a congregation where you had two elders who literally lived right across the street from one another. They didn't say a word to one another. You know, they hated one another. So knowing that you're an Israelite means absolutely nothing. That's not a solution. And John 14:6 says that Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. And that's the focal point. You know what I'm saying? So how could you – that should be the end of this, of the discussion right there. You know, knowing your nationality doesn't mean a thing. And you know, that's all I got to say with that.
Well, the main thing is when you start making national.
Go ahead, Sherry.
Well, the main thing is when you start making nationality and all these other points, the focal points above Christ or even beyond God, that's another form of idolatry. You're committing idolatry and not knowing that you're doing it. So that's more important. It becomes a sick conversation. It doesn't become about God. It becomes all about you, which is a complete heresy, which is another thing of the way the Sadducees and the Pharisees did. This is why Jesus in Matthew 23, he sounded it so magnificent that you guys are so focused on your garments and your skin colors and they want everybody to see you. You want to be seen. You want to be heard. Like you really somebody. What about Christ? Isn't Christ the main focal point? Isn't Christ the one who came and did everything? Isn't Christ the one that literally took time to save your wretched behind? But you got nerve to make it all about you. You people make me sick, literally. And I think you do a disservice to God, literally. Like I said before, if you're not going to deal with the word of God in its entirety and be sincere about it, don't touch it at all. I'm done.
All right, family, just to let y'all know, right now we have like 47 minutes left on the air. However, whenever you guys want to wrap it up, you can go all the way if y'all want to. Whenever y'all want to wrap it up, just let me know. We got more people standing by with questions and comments. Again, that number is 319-527-6239. You're now listening to the Bay Talk. It's the hot seat segment. Let's go immediately to the next call. Let's see who's here. Let's go to 516-643. You're live in there.
Shalom. Hello?
Shalom.
Hello.
Hey, peace, brother. My name is Rabbi Lewis. Rabbi Lewis. I'm Quake Mills, still Long Island, on the chat room. Yeah, hello?
Yeah, what's
we
up?
Hear you,
hey,
brother.
Yeah, brother, we hear you.
Yeah. Cool, yeah. Concerning, obviously I'm an Israelite, concerning the Holocaust, if you look at the history, it was something called the Black Plague. And the Black Plague was, it was a Black Plague during the time of Hitler and the so-called Jewish Armageddon, you know, the so-called, you know, they were burning Jews, you know. But if you look in the history, they were burning people to stop the Black Plague from spreading, not because they were the ethnic, you know, trying to, you know, ethnically, you know what I mean? I don't know the exact word I want to use. Anyway, you know, like the, you know, they were being plagued by the Black Plague, so they were burning bodies to prevent the Black Plague from spreading. But anyway, what I really wanted to talk about was how do we know that you're Israelites as Black people in America? If you read Deuteronomy chapter 28:68, I'm sure you guys are familiar with that, right?
Oh yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, it tells you that the so-called Jews will go back into Egypt again with ships. Now, if you read the book of Josephus, you know the Israelites literally went in back into Egypt in ships, and no man will buy you. And these Egyptians that were there didn't want to buy us, so the so-called Edomites, they pushed us into Nigeria. And they knew exactly where we were during the transatlantic slave trade. They went right into Nigeria and took us out of Nigeria and brought us to America. You see? In Hosea chapter 6, it tells you that for 2 days we would be that the Israelites would be cut off. And then the third day we would raise back up. If you study, you know, a day into the Lord is 1,000 years and 1,000 years is 1 day. So we would be cut off for 2,000 years and then the third day we would raise back up.
Caller, can I ask you a question on Deuteronomy 28, which you brought up?
Yeah.
On Deuteronomy 28, verse 36 says, The Lord will bring you and your king, whom you set over you, to a nation that neither you nor your fathers have known. My question, caller, is who is the king that was brought over during the transatlantic slave trade? It was the king of all them folks on the west coast of Africa.
No, it's talking about the Jeremiah tells you that David would never want another person to sit in his stead. You know, he would never want no one another king. The king's bloodline went into slavery with us. The bloodline of the kings, of which is you have to be a descendant
the
of
bloodline. I hear your answer. I'm not trying to. I just want to make sure we stay relevant. It doesn't say the king's bloodline. It actually gets specific where it says you and your king, and then it gets specific whom you set over you. So this would have to be a king who was appointed to them at that time. Who was the king that came over during the transatlantic slave trade?
The curses are perpetual. They're perpetual. You know, we went through certain.
Okay, I hear you.
In the book of Judges. Yeah.
But who was that king during that time? Because wouldn't he have to also be, if it's perpetual, I hear you, it could happen a number of times. But who was the king during that specific time, during TSA?
If you go to lulu.com, my name is Rabbi Lewis, RIBBILEWIS. I wrote a book called Where Do White People Come From? History Unraveled. You could check my readout and get edification on it.
All right.
Anyway, the question is.
Let me say this real quick.
Are you saying in the book it answers the question of who the king was, though? Are you saying?
Because the question is being a Hebrew Israelite important. Hosea 6 tells you, we'd be cut off for 2 days. Hold on. We'd be cut off for 2 days, and then the third day we were raised back up. We're in the third day. The third day started when William S. Crawley, who taught our people that we were Israelites in the 1800s. We got cut off from our nationality around.
I have a question for you.
Wait, hold on. So real. Hold on, listen, bro. Do not ask this dude no questions. Let's not ask him no questions. Just make your statement, and let's, because this right here, we not finna get off into no guy who is dealing with. I don't know if he don't know we deal with history. He must don't know that. But let's just get off into the give a statement
you. I feel
and
you.
Then let's move.
I agree.
Yeah, you're right.
We do have more callers. Stand by. Let's go to the next caller. Let's go to 919-599. You're live in there. 919-599.
Hey, my shalom, car. This is for Vocab Malone. Are you a Greek scholar or a Greek-speaking scholar?
I've taken Greek at a seminary, and I've been able to sight read it, but no, I'm not a Greek scholar, no.
Okay, my name is Okan Shayel. Could you break down John 1:1 in Greek and put it back in the proper English for us? I want you to focus on the verb eni. Eni. Look at it very careful, and look at that, and explain that to us.
All right,
John 1:1 in Greek. Then
all right,
explain it better. That's in proper English. Verb, subject, object.
All right. In arche, in ha logos, kai ha logos, in pros tante, on kai ha logos, en theos. So that's the prologue, John 1:1 right there. And that's the Greek. And what it says is this: in the beginning, that's arche, was the word, that's logos. So we have the establishment of the word was in the beginning. And Kai, so it joins the two things together, and the Logos, Ha Logos, was with God. So whoever or whatever this word was, so far we're establishing in the second part of the first verse that the word was with God, which is Theos. But then there's a monkey wrench thrown into it from what you might expect, the very next line, which is Kai Ha Logos in Theos, and the word was God. So that very same word who was in the beginning and was with God somehow yet also is God. So this tells us a number of things, one of which there's more than one person to be identified as Theos, but yet this person is not identical in the way that you might think. And that gets opened up later on in the chapter in verse 14, which it says glory as of the only son from the father. And that key word there is only, which is monogenes. Sometimes in the KJV, it might say only begotten. And so you have a clear attestation there to the deity and divinity of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, okay. So are you putting Christ Are you putting Christ in that verse 1?
Oh, no, no. We don't have to do that. We don't have to. I hear what you're saying on that, and that's a good question.
Okay,
but we don't have to do that because we go to verse 17, and then it speaks about who it's speaking about. And that's not the only place, because there it says grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. And then it says in verse 18, no one has ever seen God, the only God who is at the Father's side, and he has made him known. And then also later on, it talks about John the Baptist confessing that Christ. And so Christ is explicitly identified as the Logos there in John 1. So all we do is put it together, because we also have verse 14, which says Son from the Father, who is, this is also a clear identification as the Logos, as Christ. Otherwise, you have a Logos separate from Christ, and the question would be, who is the Word that became flesh and dwelt among us, if not Christ? Because verse 14 says, Kai ha Logos, egenetel sarx kai eskenason en hamen kai. That means the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. So yes, the Word, the Logos, is Christ, according to the Greek construction, following the flow of the passage from John 1 on.
Mm-hmm. Well, So when we look at aki in the beginning, and we look at the verb any one, would you say that word was? Could the word was be one?
Well, you're
could
talking
it be
about
expressing thought. I'm talking about. Let me read it as you read it. In ho logos ka hologos in pros to theos ka theos hologos. Now, as you notice, in the second part of theos, it renders the Holy Ghost. Holagos.
No, my friend. You got a couple issues. Number one is, and I don't mean this in a disrespectful way, but it's clear you're not really clear on the pronunciation of Greek, because whenever you're seeing that ah sound, you're saying oh. But the Greek has, whenever you see that, like that H-O, is translated as in the word the, it's ah as in omelet. That's the sound. It's not
the
logo.
I know the diphthongs.
I know, but the way you pronounce it, you did the O's like an English speaker would do. And so it's not ho logos. It's which could get you to make it think it sounds like Holy Ghost. It's ha logos. That's the correct Greek way to say it.
Yes, I know.
So
I know my diphthongs.
You're not going to be able to get Holy Ghost, although Holy Ghost is certainly in John, but he ain't there.
No. I did not make selecta. I did not make to say Holy Ghost. I understand the diphthongs in the double consonant, what are the sounds? My thing is, in John 1:1, my question to you is this Christ right here in John 1:1, or are we saying the Word was with the Most High?
Okay.
So how can
I'm
John
not sure why you're asking the same question, because the question has been answered, but let me repeat where the question is answered. I'll read a different verse that I haven't read yet that shows you that it's the Christ. Verse 15 says, John bore witness about him and cried out, this was he of whom I said, he who comes after me ranks before me, because he was before me. So who did John bear witness about? John the Baptist in this instance. Of course, it is the Christ. So every identification here shows us that the Word, the Logos, is Christ. But I don't really understand what you would get by having it not be him. What would be the theological accomplishment if your grammar was correct?
Basically, I'm asking you a question about the subject of John 1:1.
Right.
I never say it was not Christ or it was Christ. I'm getting some grammatical understanding from you, since you are a Greek word speaker of New Testament document.
Okay.
That's all.
Well, I'm sorry that maybe I misunderstood your intent. I apologize.
Okay.
I shouldn't have looked at it that way. I apologize for that. I was being too hasty and zealous. Please forgive me. I just made myself rude. I'm sorry.
All right. Anybody else want to respond before we go to the next call?
Is he trying to imply that Jesus wasn't God?
Right.
Are you trying to imply that Jesus was not God?
Yeah, hold on. Let me go back to his phone line. I'm hearing the echo, guys.
Yeah,
what are you saying? Go ahead,
919. All right, somebody got
to
get mic.
So what you trying to say? I'm trying to say that that Jesus was not God. If that's a question
that's
you say
question.
I'm trying to say?
That's a question
I'm
posing.
To
I want to know if you're trying to say that Jesus was not the Logos, that he wasn't God.
I'm saying what the take say. What does the take say?
The text says that he was God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And I don't need to be a Greek scholar to be able to bring that truth out, because all you got to do is look at what it says in John 1:1, then go to Revelation John chapter 1, verses 17 and 18, where it talks about him being the first and the last, or the Alpha and the Omega, the first letter in the Greek alphabet and the last letter in the Greek alphabet. And he died, and behold, he was alive. He was talking about Jesus, a deity at that time.
Well, I have a question for him. Can I ask him?
Well, I like only answer my question first, because he was saying,
So now you want to go to a
book of Revelation?
Guys, let's move on.
So when we talk about the word in Hebrew, it's dabar, and the logos in what Greek. I understand it's a Tuesday Greek, New Testament Greek very well, so don't get it twisted. So you want to go to a apocalyptic book, the book of Revelation? Now, I asked the question.
Right.
Sir, you were criticizing John chapter 1. You were criticizing John chapter 1, and I simply said that Jesus is the Logos in John chapter 1. And it says, and I quote, in the beginning was the Logos. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Are you now going to tell me that Thomas did not worship Jesus?
That's a really good question.
I think Vocab did an excellent job, and what happened was this brother did the Hebrew shuffle. That's what you can look that up. It's called Hebrew shuffle.
Before we move on, I just really did want to ask him one simple question. Jesus, your Savior.
No, Jesus is not my Savior. Yah's my Savior.
Okay.
Yes, you're absolutely
so,
no.
Same thing.
Right. So, all right.
No, Jesus is not my Savior, and he's not my God.
And so, in other words, so Jesus is not God.
No, Jesus is not God. Whenever God get killed,
okay.
He said that Jesus wasn't the Savior.
He basically condemned himself when he did that. Sir, you need Jesus Christ. You need to repent of your sins and come to the knowledge of truth. While you still got hope.
Yeah, real quick, all I wanted to say was, you know, I just want someone to reconcile to me John 1:18, where it says, "No one has ever seen God," right? And there's a semicolon. He's gonna better explain what he's talking about. He says, "The only God," right? Then he's gonna better explain what he's talking about even more. Who is at the Father's side. He has made him known. So the Father has made the only God known. And throughout the chapter of chapter 1, it's saying that the Word was God and the Word was made flesh. I mean, this is as grammatically simple as it gets. So, you know, I understand what you believe, but when you come to John 1:1, it does not yield your belief. And I think Vocab showed that plainly. I think the only way to you be consistent is to give up the New Testament altogether. But that's the last thing that we would ever want you to do.
Yeah, and I like to say this too. After April 30th, I would gladly debate you on that topic on whether or not Jesus Christ is the Savior or whether or not it's the Father. And I believe it would be one of the quickest debates I've ever had on this channel before.
All right, once again, it's the Hot Seat segment. We had the Soldiers of God. For those just joining to the show, we had the Soldiers of God right on the panel. Again, the number is 319-527-6239. We have about 30 minutes left on the air. Again, we're going to take some of your questions, your comments, and after that, I'm going to get some last words when we get close to the end of the show. But we're going to take some more of your questions. Let's see. Let's go to 1614. I believe it's my brother from Australia. What's going on? How you doing? 1614, can you hear me? All right, going once. 1614, going twice. All right, unfortunately, we got to move on. Let's go to 843-908. You're live in the air.
How's it going? Can you guys hear me? Hello, can y'all hear me?
Yes, we can.
Yeah,
we can.
How you doing, man?
Okay, I'm sorry.
Peace,
hey, how's
bro.
It going, man?
Peace.
How's it going, Sal, and everybody on the panel? This is Brother Jaron. Many people know me, remember me as Jesseron or Jada Producer. I know I met Brother Marcus. I was in IUIC a little while ago, and so far I separated from them after I've seen this funniness with the doctrine. So there was two things I wanted you guys to kind of hit on. So the first thing is Isaiah 28, because we know this is the fundamental verse that most Hebrew Israelites hold dear to say that this is how you're supposed to understand the scriptures. But we also understand that during the time of Moses, Isaiah wasn't alive, nor was the prophecy given to him to write down Isaiah 28. To explain to them is that, number one, to show that, first of all, that scripture was mocking the leaders of the people at that time. It was not a code to unlock the scriptures. And if it was a code to unlock the scriptures, then what did God think of all the previous generations who had not that verse? And how were they to understand the very scriptures that they were reading, not having that code to unlock it? And the second thing was about 1 Kings 8 and 46, about to be thinking of themselves, the Israelites be thinking themselves. We know that in majority of the captivities that Israel went in, they still remembered their nationality, their forefathers. We have the example of the woman of Samaria, even in the New Testament, remembering that she was a descendant of Jacob. So they weren't lost and oblivious to who their forefathers were. So when the scriptures talk about to be thinking of themselves, that it was talking about their heritage or their laws at that time, Moses. So if you guys can hit on those two facts, because I know a lot of brothers and sisters hold dear to that, to show them that is, number one, Isaiah 20 is not the code to unlock the Bible, and that to be thinking of himself at that time was talking about coming back to the law of Moses, which was the heritage of Israel at that time. And that's
Let me say, hey, man, that's an excellent point, man. I would like to link up with you, man, some way afterwards or whatever. But, yeah, the speakers there in verse 9 of Isaiah 28 are probably the prophets and the priests who are mentioned there in verse 7 and 8. And they was mad at Isaiah because they felt like Isaiah was treating them like they were little kids. If you read the entire passage, you could get this context. But they're like, hey, we're adults. We don't need somebody to tell us how to think. And so what they ended up doing actually was mocking and mimicking Isaiah as if he was talking baby talk to them. Now, let me show you where I get that from. It actually shows up really well in the Hebrew, and I don't claim to be a great pronouncer of Hebrew, but I can tell you this because this is how it sounds in the Hebrew, the series of sounds there. It says, Saul, 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 qual, 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 qual. So they're actually mocking it, and the phonetic sounds sound like baby talk, like that's how they're getting lectured. And so when they say here a little, there a little, do, and all that, rule on rule, precept, precept, it's not an interpretive method. It's actually unbelieving Israelites mocking God's instruction to them. And how ironic is it that a lot of Hebrew Israelites take that as the way you interpret the scripture? Nah, man, that's the wrong road.
Right, and you also see later on, I think it's in verse 13, when he says, you know, the same thing that you was mocking is going to be the same thing that's going to mess you up.
Yep.
You know? So... Yeah.
So I'm glad you brought that out, caller.
No problem.
That's a hashtag fire.
Right. And brother Jay Producer, I do remember you, man. I do remember you. God bless you, bro. God bless you, man. So, hey, I used to listen to that song, man.
Hey, Lord, do I keep putting them out, man?
All right.
Just to let you know, we lost Veckel. Veckel call dropped. And also, I've been informed that Brother Marcus has to go. So, Brother Marcus, you want to say your last words now? Go ahead.
Sure. Well, I just want to thank you, Brother Sal, for having me on the show. And I want to say, you know, God bless to all the members of SOG and all the audience out there listening. I hope that this was beneficial for you guys. Hope that y'all learned some things. And if you ever want to get in contact with me, you can, reach me on Facebook. Just type in Marcus Webb. You can find me, reach out to me on Facebook. And also tune in to the videos that are put out there on G-Man's channel on YouTube. Check out LaRon G Consciousness channel. check out Brother Surreal's channel. And you know, we love y'all, man. And there's a lot of stuff that we do behind the scenes, man. And you know, this is not a game to us, you know. So we're trying our best to help brothers and sisters out that are going through you know, a lot of tough situations that have been spawned due to this movement, the Israelite movement, primarily coming from the One West camps. There's a lot of problems that's going on with, you know, concerning families and how it's destroying families and marriages and stuff like that. And so that's one of the things that we do a lot in trying to help bring those things back together and keep the families together and the marriages together and stuff like that. It takes a lot of effort and energy in that. And so, you know, for those out there listening, you know, I pray that y'all, I hope that y'all are praying for one another. And, you know, and like I said, God bless y'all. Thank y'all for having me on the show.
All right, so, you know, that's Brother Marcus. We, like I said, we lost Beckel, and we also lost Vocab Malone. So what we're going to do, I guess we, you know, we pretty much wrap it up, fellas. We want to take one more call. What you want to do?
Yeah, I want to let me say something real quick before, and then I'm going to jet out too, actually, because I got to get to this class in the morning. I just want to say shout out to you, Sal. Thanks for having us on, as well as the rest of the SOG family. And also the audience out there, praise to the Most High, first off. You know, I think, you know, there's a, we attack this because we see this in our neighborhoods. We see this in our area, in our areas a lot, you know, and we as ministers of the gospel, you know, and we have the message of reconciliation to reconcile the people back unto God, according to what befell them in Genesis chapter 11. With the falling away that took place with the Tower of Babel, you know, Abraham was sent out. He heard the word of the Lord, and faith come by hearing and hearing of the word, and he heard it and he hearkened to it. And he didn't harden his heart. He didn't harden his heart, but he followed God. And so God has used that very word that we see today for us, as in the book of Galatians tells us that the gospel was preached unto Abraham. And how God would justify the heathen by faith and by his grace and his mercy. So we ourselves have that ministry of reconciliation to reconcile those people back into God as being priests just as well, because that's what priests do. They are mediators between God and man, and we are to reconcile man back unto God, as well as Christ, which is the high priest, who stained his blood and shed his blood as being innocent, which we who are priests are definitely in need of, to be cleansed by blood, and also for our sins to be buried just as well. Christ was the blood who was innocent blood who was shed, signified as an animal, as a lamb, or as some type of clean animal for priestly duties to go in unto the holiest of holies, as well as it was mentioned before our father Abraham when he sinned and he tried to resolve his sin by covered himself with something other than the blood. And later on, blood was shed and two coats of skins was made and put on Adam and Eve, our mother, and so our mother and father. So there's nothing that we can ever do to cover our own sins. So God himself made them coats of skin and covered them. And so this is symbolic of blood being shed, innocent blood, because that animal didn't have to die, because that animal did not sin. But Adam and Eve, our mother and father, sinned. So we have to recognize that these things that we see that are symbolic in the Bible points us to a people, you know, who would recognize the blood. And by that blood that they will recognize will cause a difference within them, or put a difference between them and other people, you know. So that's the only difference that we see is the blood. It is by the blood that we pass from death. The blood is the middle wall. You know, you have to pass. I mean, you can't get to God except you, you know, plead the blood or put the blood posted up, Pesach or Pesach. So I just wanted to bring that out, you know, for those that deal with the Old Testament, you might understand a little bit of my language, and those that deal with the New Testament, you should understand a lot of my language because the New Testament shed light on those things that were symbolic in the past. So I just want to say peace to the audience out there, you know, peace to, you know, the family, you know, just as well. Keep tuning in and listening in. We're dealing with atheism. We're dealing with, you know, not just that, the white Hebrew Israelites, the Asiatic Hebrew Israelites, the black Hebrew Israelites, you know, this preaching false doctrine. We're dealing with it, you know, all of it. Whether you're a black atheist or white atheist or whatever atheist you want to be, we're dealing with that. God wants to bring all people unto him. So that's the agenda. Yes, we want to convert you. We want to see you. We want to see you saved. We want to see you repent. Peace and blessings. Make sure y'all tune into G Consciousness Radio. Also, you know, tune in to my channel, G Consciousness on YouTube. Peace to the family out there. Sister Cherry, peace to you. Brother Vocab, Brother Vacu, Cleveland. Also, who was the other brother? So Real. You know, peace to everybody, Marcus, that was on the panel. Peace to the SOG, you know. Peace to the brother, Faithful to God, you know, who was one of the co-founders of SOG. You know, peace to that brother just as well. And so with that being said, peace and blessings to the family out there.
All right, so we might as well get some last words. Sister Sherry, last words. Okay.
Well, I want to say definitely it was a pleasure being on your show tonight, Sal. Shout out to you. I have mad respect for your platform, even though this is like my first time in like this. So I'm truly honored. To my brothers in the SOG, they know I love all of them, and I have so much respect for them. To the ones that are caught up in this heresy, you know, especially the one West Camp, you guys need to get saved and find Christ, definitely. I've come to realize with 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 3, you can't see Christ without the Holy Spirit, and that's my prayer for you, that you guys really, truly do find Christ and that you do accept the Holy Spirit and accept Christ for who he is and who he said he was, is, and still will be forevermore. Even though I may come across kind of harsh, but it's out of righteous anger and out of righteous love. I do love you because that's what I'm called to do. You know, I just want to see all get saved. I just want to see all come to Christ and love one another as Christ had loved us. There is no other way, as Chikan was stating. We can't go, there's no other way to God but through Christ and being covered under his blood. So I just pray that people will open up their eyes and drop this malicious talk and just put in nationality first over Christ. It's bad. But with that being said, I wish all of you peace, blessings to each and every home. And just know that Sister Cherry loves you with the love of Christ. God bless. Good night.
All right, let's go to G-Man. G-Man, last words.
Yeah, I'll try to be brief. I just want to directly talk to the Hebrew Israelites out there without, like, trying to repeat everything that you guys just heard already. I want to remind you guys, and I'm being serious with this now, okay, that your whole movement started by a guy who was in a bar who said he was visited by an angel with a perfect afro. And that's how all of this got started. If you would just take the time out and actually think about that, think about all of the correction you guys have gotten with SOG coming to debate talk for you, that should be enough to get you to really, really, really start thinking about your position. And when you think about your position, think about the consistency of your position, saying that blacks are the Israelites when the Bible says they were ready to read. You have to ask yourself, the people that taught you these things, did they take the Bible out of context? Did they teach you wrong things? Like, you just had this caller here say that God was a savior and Jesus wasn't. And if you just go read the scriptures for yourself, you will see that the Father did not die for your sins. It was Jesus who died for your sins. And you need to take that into some deep consideration, because eternity is a long time. And once he throws you in that lake of fire, there is no timeout. There is no peace you're going to get from that. There's going to be gnawing and gnashing of the teeth. That's going to be torment for all of eternity. So this ain't a game. This ain't a game. We all messed up. We're all sinners. And every last one of you need to acknowledge that. You need to acknowledge the fact that you need a Savior and you need Jesus Christ right now. Do it while you got the opportunity. Believe in your heart that God rose up from the dead on the third day, and you will have eternal life. Place your faith in him alone, and you will have eternal life. You know I come across as being a little bit rough with dealing with the Hebrew Israelites, whether I'm dealing with them in public or whether or not I'm dealing with them in private. But I do want to let you guys know that everything I do is to get you guys to change your mind and to come to Jesus. Some people do it a little nicer than me, I suppose. And then some people might be a little bit more harsher than me. But at the end of the day, we got the same goal. We want to see you guys get saved. So whether your name is Pastor Doel, or your name is General Yohana, or your name is Tazariot, or your name is Tazadakia, or your name is Great Millstone, who called in a little bit earlier, it doesn't matter. At the end of the day, you need to drop this ridiculous ideology, and you need to come to Jesus Christ. Why you still got time? Why you still got hope? Stop compromising the faith. If you don't love Jesus, say it. Don't sit here and pretend to love him because you believe he's helping your black nationalism. Okay? When you become born again, you're not part of the world no more. You're part of the kingdom of God. And your mind is not on worldly things or earthly things no more. Your mind is on heavenly things. Just keep that in mind when you guys come on here and you're doing your debating and you're talking to one another and you're talking about us. Because at the end of the day, we all want you to have eternal life. If you guys want to check me out on YouTube, check out the G Podcast on Mondays at 7:30 Eastern Standard Time. I invite the Hebrew Israelites to come in there to have a cordial conversation, or they can call into the show with their questions. You can also check out G Consciousness Channel, Vekul's Channel, Vocab Malone's Channel, Brother Marcus. I don't even know if he has a YouTube channel, but I know he mentioned that he's on Facebook. So you can contact us. Sister Cherry's very approachable. You can contact her and talk to her if you need some counseling or if you're having problems coming out of this movement. We're very approachable. We don't think we're God. We're not like the One West camps that believe that they're untouchable and don't have to talk to nobody. If you guys need if you need a shoulder, give us a call, and we'll help you with that decision about Jesus. Thank you, Sal, for having me on here, and I hope that I can get on here again after my marathon. God bless.
All right, and final words, so real, last words.
You know, my last words of this, and, you know, just like the rest of the team said, this is not a joke. We're serious about this. You know, there's a lot of off-air stuff that I'm not ready to come out with yet, but I will share one thing. There was a guy, I'll keep him anonymous, but he was an ex-IUIC member from the Pittsburgh area. And he told me that, you know, one of the reasons that he started to actually slowly find himself getting out of the Israelite movement was because they would change the titles of their lessons, but they would teach the same stuff. And he said that he found his notes literally being the same because they don't teach the whole Bible. That's a problem. You know, when you actually look at the Bible and look at especially church history, does it line up with your narrative of what you believe? If it doesn't, that's a problem. If Jesus says in Matthew 25 that, listen, when I was hungry, you fed me. When I was sick, you healed me. When I was this, you did that. And they said, well, when did we do this? And Jesus said, well, when you did it to the least of these, you did it to me. Jesus never said that they didn't have to be Edomites or they had to be non-Edomites or this and that. No. He equated the entire world with himself. God forbid any Israelite would do that. But yet, this is what he says. And he said, you know what? Because you did these things, come on into the kingdom. Well, time out. What about the law of Moses?
And yet he's saying to the other guys, well, when I was hungry, you didn't feed me. When I was in prison, you didn't visit me. And because of that, go ahead and go into everlasting darkness. And, well, wait, when did we not do these things to you? Well, when you skipped over all those people, you skipped over me. But Lord, they were Edomites. They were, you know, terrible Gentiles. That narrative is not found in the context. How is it that you have, well, the curses are perpetual? That's what he said in Deuteronomy 28. Because he couldn't prove that it was just linear prophetic. They had to be ongoing. That's the only way he can make his argument consistent. But it runs flat into a contradiction where the New Testament literally says that Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. And then if you want to find another curse, it says, look, he that preaches another gospel, whether he be an angel or something like that, let him be accursed. So if you're preaching another gospel and you're looking around and you're saying that you're accursed, you can't say it's because of the Old Testament, because we're in the New Testament. It may be because of something else. It may be because of what you're pushing. And we don't want y'all to do that. If I were you guys, I would read Philippians 3. I'm not going to go through it all, but it was the least theological book that Paul ever wrote. And it was actually written to a Gentile church, you know, specifically a Gentile church in the European area. They said it was the first one, which I find very ironic. He said in verse 4, look, I have a reason to be confident in my flesh. He said, if anyone thinks that they're to be confident in the flesh, he said, I have more. And guess what? He started naming all this Jewish stuff. He said, I was circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews. And he said, as to a law, I was a Pharisee. As to zeal, I persecuted the church. This is Paul talking in Philippians 3. As to righteousness under the law, huh, I was blameless. But whatever gain I had, I counted it as loss for the sake of Christ. Now, time out. Why is there a dichotomy between the law and Jesus? Why is it there? Why is that a theme throughout the New Testament? Indeed, I count everything as loss for the surpassing of the worth of knowing Christ as Jesus my Lord. Time out. What did John say? We wrote these things to you that you may believe. What did Jesus say? You know, this is eternal life, that you may know me. And yet, there it is, Paul's letters. He's saying, you know, it's surpassing worth of knowing Christ my Lord. Now, I could have went all throughout the rest of the chapter, but just read this stuff. And it just goes on and on. Not that I've already attained this or am already perfect, but I press on to make it known, but Christ Jesus has made me his own. Christ said that, you know what, the Bible and the Old Testament is not about the Israelites. As he said, it's about me. He said, you search the scriptures thinking that you in them you may have eternal life. But he said, you don't realize that it all speaks of me. That's what Jesus actually said. He took the whole Old Testament and he said, it's about me. How many of your leaders say, oh, well, actually, the whole Bible is actually about Israel. It's about you. That's idolatry. And it runs straight in a contradiction to what Jesus says. And so, like I said, we could do this all night, but the bottom line is, you know, we want y'all saved. You know, we want y'all in Christ, not just in some nation. What's better, being in Christ or in a nation? If you say that there's both, try to find that narrative in the New Testament. I can't find it. You know, and so, like I said, hit us up. You know, I'm ssoreal@gmail.com. Email us. I'll even give you my number, 412-863-5173. And, you know, we would love to continue these talks because, you know, we don't want you to end up, you know, giving up Christ in this pursuit of something that really isn't going to profit you that much, you know. But other than that, that's all I really had to say. I could have said more, but, you know, maybe I'll just leave it right there. God bless y'all.
2017. Big talk for you. What up? Shout out Albo King. Big Boo. Me.
you can absorb. Information's being charged so you can afford. Get popping, live off the greatest doctrine. Sip the juice, know the ledge like the great Rockham. On a mission, not a small time thing. Defense, biblical, offense, got the haters watching. Hands are still, footwork is still. Get in the den, see if you can stand for real. If you rep him and cool, yo, I rep Israel. If you Torah based only or new as well, welcome to listen. Style always fair decision. Two sides come together to compare what's written. Seeking the facts, seeking the match, teaching the act, leaking the tracks. Call while you eating your snacks.